Hello everyone, welcome to the DBS Yen Review, a look back at the politics, social issues, personalities and stories that shaped 2016. The year started on a somber note, with the island recording its first homicide and first road fatality in the first week of 2016. The Jofali affair and the wrangling over the citizenship and investment program dominated headlines from January to July. But as we'll see later, the year also had its share of jubilation. I'm Timothy Poldion, and this is the DBS Year in Review. Stay tuned as we recall the stories, newsmakers, and events that defined 2016. The 2016 Year in Review is brought to you by Casabella and Rhythm FM. 2016 got off to a violent start after a 9-year-old feud between neighbors span out of control. The altercation between two women quickly escalated, and before it was over, several more persons had become involved and one man was left nursing stab wounds. The incident actually occurred on December 31st of 2015, but on January the 1st of 2016, 45-year-old Joseph Herman of Capitol Hill would breathe his last breath and become the first homicide victim for the year.
Melissa Joseph was charged with that murder. Joseph's outlandish behavior at her first court appearance attracted more media attention than the case itself, and also gave rise to questions about media restrictions and access to courthouses, witnesses, and accused persons. The need for tighter court security was raised again when another murder accused spat on a television reporter, while one of the accused in the Lambert's human trafficking scandal was allowed to conduct interviews and to pass notes to reporters. The island recorded its second homicide 5 days into the year when 42-year-old Marcus Nelson of Monrepore Hill Library was hacked to death. The St. Lucia Chamber of Commerce was quick to express concern about the early start to the violence and about the impact of crime on businesses generally. The chamber called for steps to be taken to prevent the situation from reaching dire levels, but as we learn later, the business community would have a lot more to say on the subject of crime as it would hit uncomfortably close to home. Interestingly, the police would later that month release crime statistics that showed a decrease in the murders for the previous 4 years. St. Lucia officially launched its Citizenship by Investment program in January. The program provides a direct route to citizenship based on investment. It would be the subject of a long war of words between the Prime Minister Kenny Anthony and UWP political leader Alan Chasney. The Prime Minister accused Chasney of being a hypocrite when it came to the Citizenship by Investment program. Chasney had been critical of the board overseeing the CIP and had called for the highest standard of due diligence and vetting of investor applications in order to ensure only persons of impeccable reputation are admitted. However, Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony said Chasney was inconsistent in his statements about the program.
Chasney's party was involved in developing the Citizenship by Investment program. They were represented on the committee. When the legislation went to Parliament, they supported the legislation. They understood what the legislation was all about. Therefore, to be suggesting at this stage, because he has this morbid fear of Ernest Hilaire, and I don't really know why he has this morbid fear of Ernest Hilaire, he takes that kind of position. First of all, this is inconsistent with his postures prior to his statements.
Chasney, Anthony said, did not have the country's best interest at heart. Diplomats from the European Union joined the U.S. in applying pressure on St. Lucia to act on the impacts report on investigations into allegations of extrajudicial police killings. A high-level delegation met with Prime Minister Kenny Anthony to discuss the matter and to call for the appointment of a Director of Public Prosecutions, or DPP. The woman holding the office was due to retire in a matter of weeks.
We've conveyed to the Prime Minister our strong message that almost a year now after his address to the nation in March 2015, when he presented the impacts report to the public, there has to be action. And due to due process with regard to the allegations of extrajudicial killings, by members of the St. Lucia Royal Police Force is an indispensable condition for a system that respects the principle of rule of law. We fully respect that the Prime Minister has no direct control over the judicial branch, and that there is a separation of powers. And as I said, we really respect the Constitution in every which way there is, but it is still the remit of the Prime Minister and his government to put the Director of Public Prosecution in a situation where there are resources available that can carry out the work of the Director of Public Prosecutions.
Meanwhile, the U.S. was becoming more openly critical of the Prime Minister's handling of the impacts report. The U.S. State Department accused the Prime Minister of inaction in going after those alleged to have committed extrajudicial police killings. The Prime Minister, who had been silent on the issue up until then, did not take too kindly to the assertions.
The Director of Public Prosecutions herself publicly stated that she never read the report until a full 6 months following her receipt of it. Up until the time that the DPP proceeded on pre-retirement leave in December of 2015, she never requested the government of St. Lucia to facilitate her to receive witness statements or to interview the investigators, whether in St. Lucia or Jamaica. To the charge that the Office of the Director of Public Prosecutions was not provided with the requisite resources to prosecute this matter, the Minister for National Security responded promptly and fully, debunking the DPP's assertion.
UWP political leader Alan Chastney began applying some pressure of his own, expressing doubt that the Prime Minister could deliver on his promise to EU diplomats to appoint a DPP and a deputy DPP by April that year. Instead, he told St. Lucians to prepare for the likely fallout of the government's failure to deliver on international demands for due process in the impacts case.
Well, I think I totally appreciate and understand the concern that the British and the Europeans have expressed with regards to the impacts. I think that this thing has dragged along too long. As far as the Prime Minister's pronouncements, you know, I remain very skeptical, because here we have a situation in which he's been dealing with this for 4 years and he's not been able to resolve it, and he's not made the resources available. Why would I believe, or would anybody believe, that in the next 4 months he's going to do that? And the fact is that the Prime Minister has shown by his behavior and his actions that he clearly has not had an intention of resolving this matter. You know, he is a person who is a lawyer. He's a constitutional lawyer. He's been a Prime Minister for 15 years. And when we see some of the basic mistakes that were made, so...
Four of the Nepalese nationals caught up in the Lambert's Academy human trafficking scandal left the island after being here for almost a year. The students had for weeks before that been demanding their passports be returned and for them to leave the country after dissatisfaction with the handling of their case by the government. While here, their plight became the subject of a documentary aimed at drawing international attention to their case. The government of St. Lucia stuck by its decision not to waive the diplomatic immunity of Saudi billionaire Dr. Waleed Jafali, despite local and international pressure to do so. The government of St. Lucia informed the Foreign and Commonwealth Office in the UK that it intended to uphold the principle of diplomatic immunity by allowing its permanent representative to the International Maritime Organization to invoke its diplomatic immunity in the civil case brought by his ex-wife. The government maintained its position that the parties should have been allowed to settle their matrimonial dispute through negotiations, and failing that, the courts would decide if immunity could be waived in the matter. Meanwhile, the opposition continued to express concern about the international fallout from the government's decision. Leader of the opposition, Dr. Gail Rigobert, expressed fears that the island could be slapped with a travel advisory over its handling of the affair. Others, including a former ambassador, thought the entire controversy was much ado about nothing.
No, I don't think so. I have been hearing this thing. As I said, we sometimes take ourselves too seriously. This is a matter that has been really in the London tabloids. And you know the tabloids love this kind of thing. I said the Daily Mail in June said it's going to be the biggest divorce divorce case. That's the kind of thing they thrive on. I don't think our name is being muddied for a small matter like that. It's certainly not going to make international news. As I pointed out to somebody yesterday, the West Indies lost in Australia and it was not even reported in BBC Sports News. So that's to show you how seriously they take us. Our elections are not reported internationally. Have you heard of any results of any Caribbean election being reported internationally? Right. So, you know, it's convenient political drama at home, but it's really not something that affects us.
A UK Court of Appeal would eventually rule that Dr. Wali Jafali's diplomatic immunity was irrelevant to his divorce case, but that would not stop UWP political leader Alan Shastley from questioning the government's decision to appoint the Saudi billionaire as St. Lucia's representative to the International Maritime Organization, IMO. Shastley maintained that the ruling did not excuse the government from explaining its choice of diplomat or how the country would benefit.
This is such a bigger issue than the court case. First of all, St. Lucians must ask themselves the question, why is it that they had to find out about Jafali's appointment through the British media 2 years after the fact? Why is it after our questions and many questions that are being asked, nobody's questioned how Dr. Jafali was appointed as the ambassador? We all get that. The government appointed him. The question that we're asking is, why? And what's interesting is that the lower court said what we all have been saying, is that his initial assessment is that Jafali did not have immunity simply because he had not taken up his post. He had not attended any meetings. He had done nothing, which is the same thing that we were asking, was giving the government an opportunity to explain why was Dr. Jafali appointed? What was the benefit? If he was not going to the meetings, if he has no qualifications of maritime affairs, so there was no added value, okay, why?
Also in January, family, friends, and the media fraternity were left in shock over the sudden death of sports journalist Brian McDonald. McDonald died from a heart attack.
You're watching the DBS Yen Review, a look at the headline-grabbing events of 2016. In February, the St. Lucia Labour Party kicked its election machinery into high gear. The opposition United Workers Party had consistently called for early elections. Despite suggestions of division within its ranks, the UWP had maintained that St. Lucians' dissatisfaction with government's economic and social policies would guarantee it a victory at the polls. The ruling party began a series of press conferences and political meetings, raising suspicion that it might relent on demands for an early election.
While the SLP held its series of press conferences, the United Workers' Party also began its own preparations for the poll with the hosting of various council meetings, public rallies, and endorsements of new candidates. The Lucian People's Movement, LPM, announced that it would in fact be contesting the elections. Meanwhile, the Ancillary Canaries MP, Desmond Long, announced his decision to bow out of elective politics, while downplaying suggestions that he was being forced out. His announcement followed similar news for Education Minister and Castries East MP, Robert Lewis. Speculation was rife that others in the party might follow. The electoral department also went to work encouraging all citizens to exercise their franchise to vote. The department began publishing the names of unverified voters and began its campaign to get citizens registered for the general elections. Meanwhile, a former director of the Government Information Service led calls for the staff orders to be revisited after an employee of the service landed in hot water when she announced her intention to enter elective politics. A 16-year-old girl was being charged with the murder of 57-year-old Paul St. Rose in February. The Bagatelle man was found in a pool of blood at his home. The arrest of the teen sparked a debate about whether or not juveniles should be tried as adults in courts of law.
We must make our laws in compliance with the conventions that we sign. That is our job. and that we must do. So therefore, I mean, this case raises that issue, and we must now revisit and make sure that our laws are in compliance with our conventions that we sign.
The confusion was fueled by discrepancies between the UN Convention on the Rights of the Child, to which St. Lucia is a signatory, and the local Child Protection Act. The convention stipulates that persons under the age of 18 who commit such offenses ought to be treated as minors, and that provisions ought to be made accordingly. But under the Child Protection Act, a 16-year-old who commits such an offense can be tried as an adult.
This morning is basically to inform her of her rights formally, and we have to take it from there. I have my own views about whether it can be dealt with by a magistrate, but as it is, it would have to be dealt with by a judge.
The Public Service Commission came under scrutiny over its failure to identify a replacement for Police Commissioner Vernon Francois months after he vacated the office under controversial circumstances. An article in the Star newspaper suggesting that qualified officers were being bypassed and overlooked by the PSC led to widespread public concern about what was going on at the Public Service Commission. Public Service Minister Dr. James Fletcher came out in defense of the Public Service Commission, saying there was nothing to suggest that the PSC was in violation of accepted procedure in its efforts to fill vacancies in the hierarchy of the police force. With Acting Commissioner Errol Alexander preparing to retire in April, government found itself under pressure to identify a suitable replacement. Minister Fletcher gave assurances that steps were being taken to identify a qualified replacement.
I would like to see every vacant position resolved quickly, particularly a position that is of national importance, like the position of Commissioner of Police. From what I gathered, the first set of interviews that were held did not yield a satisfactory result, so the Public Service Commission has re-advertised. I'm not quite sure when is the deadline for the receipt of applications. Hopefully, they will have a successful recruitment exercise this time, and we can hear an announcement from the Commission on a new Commissioner of Police.
The position had been advertised and the acting commissioner had applied for the position, but dissatisfaction with the modus operandi of the PSC led him to eventually withdraw. Another police officer would file for the judicial review following the PSC's rejection of his application for the post of commissioner. Local advocacy group United and Strong expressed outrage over an apparent spike in rape cases on the island. The human rights organization challenged citizens to take a stand against what some described as a rape culture. Around the same time, police announced that they were investigating two rape incidents, one involving the assault of a 22-year-old woman by two men at her workplace in broad daylight, and the other involving the rape of a 45-year-old British national at a guest house in Kasemba.
We are operating within limited resources, and like I said, sometimes people really and truly lose faith in the system. And I'm not talking about government systems only, I'm talking about systems within our society, be it systems in the church, be it social community systems, support services. People sometimes give up, especially when it comes to issues of rape, and they cannot get the necessary help they want. They just simply give up.
Gender Affairs Minister Alvina Reynolds organized a brainstorming exercise to determine what could be done to stop rape. She also joined several others calling for pepper spray to be more easily and legally accessible by women.
As a matter of fact, we have been planning a meeting of the minds consultation so we could put together our recommendation as it pertains to what can be done in the society apart from what is being done. And I've said it before, the police alone and Department of Human Services and the Ministry of Health cannot contain this. It's a call for all organizations, all agencies, all groups, churches, NGOs, all of them to rally with it, and those that clubs, men clubs, you know, wherever they socialize, wherever they meet, to add their voices and to see how they can change not only the thoughts but the behaviors.
Opposition leader Gail Rigobert expressed similar sentiments.
There ought to be areas in which we as a parliament consider some legislative fixes or redress to ensure that whether it is, and these issues are still up in the air, whether it is you tag persons who are known sex offenders, whether it is you modify the law to permit women or persons to carry certain chemical compounds, etc., to ward off potential criminals. I mean, these things ought to happen within the ambit of the law. And so certainly there is need for the legislative agenda to reflect those concerns.
The opposition UWP joined law enforcement authorities in expressing growing concern over rising number of sex attacks across the island. Of equal concern to the political party was the lack of arrests in connection with the wave of sex attacks and the continued closure of the forensic lab. The St. Lucia Association of Social Workers called for a holistic approach to tackling the increase in sexual assault cases. The association called for all sex crimes to be investigated using the available technologies and law enforcement tools needed to realize quick and successful prosecutions.
I'm saying to the lawmakers, the policymakers, we've heard it for year after year, month after year. Something has to be done. I don't know what St. Lucia is waiting for to happen. So we could sit down or put a body together to reevaluate to see how could we get best practice into our courtrooms and to have a case begin and end in a quicklier manner. I mean, matters go on for years and years until the virtual complainant decides, hey, I'm tired of this, I don't want to do this anymore. So it's time for the necessary authorities to step up.
While all of this was going on, there were reports that a local principal had found himself in hot water with the law and was being accused of carnal knowledge. There was also another case of alleged incident assault by a dance instructor. St. Lucia celebrated its 37th independence anniversary in grand style with the traditional military parade at the Mindo Philip Park in Castries. The parade had not been held at that venue for several years. St. Lucians turned out in their hundreds to witness the inspection of the guards and march past by military groups. Foreign contingents were noticeably absent in this year's activity. One newspaper speculated that it might be as a result of the European Union member dissatisfaction with the handling of the investigation into human rights abuses by local police. The French embassy would later deny the claims. Castries Southeast MP Guy Joseph, meanwhile, latched onto the newspaper report that the French government had snubbed the independence parade over dissatisfaction with government's handling of the impacts investigation report. According to the opposition politician, the full fallout from the impacts investigation was yet to be felt.
A lot of our people are able to go up to Martinique, spend 2 weeks, come back down. That is a big boost for the economy in St. Lucia. If we lose out on these opportunities, already the employment situation is so bad in St. Lucia. If France was to say, look here, we are totally unhappy with the behavior of the government of St. Lucia in how matters are being handled, and we want to make a clean break, what would happen to us here? What would happen to all our people who travel up and down, all the activity, all the French people that come in and spend money in St. Lucia? What would happen to us?
Nobel laureate Derek Walcott and former Prime Minister Dr. Vaughan Lewis both received knighthoods during the celebrations. The government announced the week before that the Queen had agreed that St. Lucia could award its own knighthoods under the National Honours and Awards Act. The award of Knight Commander and Dame Commander were awarded for the first time. Several other persons were rewarded for long and meritorious services in various fields. The opposition United Workers Party turned up the pressure on the government to clarify the role of a team of U.S. lawyers it hired, reportedly to represent its interest in talks with American officials on the impacts investigations into police abuses.
There's another important issue. That on the New Year's Eve presentation, the Prime Minister indicated that he was hiring a lobbying firm in the U.S., a group of lawyers, to lobby on behalf of the government of St. Lucia to get reprieve from the United States on the Leahy Law, and particularly to deal with impacts.
UWP Chairman Guy Mayers wanted the Prime Minister to address the nation on the outcome of his meeting with the high-level EU delegation the month before.
You could well imagine that we had these ambassadors, as was mentioned by the political leader, meeting with the Prime Minister, holding a press conference, and you'd expect that there'd be a joint press conference held after the meeting. But what did we see? They had their own press conference. To date, the Prime Minister has not addressed the country on this. All we got were press releases coming out of his office, spinning the whole issue. But the Prime Minister has not felt it important enough to address the country on this issue. And so the French, the Europeans, the British, the Americans, you'd have to ask them what their situation is.
Diplomats from the European Union met with the Prime Minister in mid-January to discuss impacts investigations into allegations of police brutality and a number of issues related to the island's justice system. While the EU diplomats called a press conference afterwards, Mayers was questioning why the Prime Minister did not see it fit to address the nation on the issues raised at that meeting. Meanwhile, star publisher and talk show host Rick Wayne joined those calling on the Prime Minister to explain what steps he had taken since his meeting with the EU delegation to address their concerns. The naming ceremony for the Owen King EU Hospital took place in February as part of activities for St. Lucia's 37th anniversary of independence. The facility was named after one of St. Lucia's most distinguished physicians, Dr. Owen King, along with the funding facility, the European Union. The government was severely criticized for hosting a naming ceremony rather than an opening ceremony for the new hospital. The criticism would come back to haunt the opposition when it was not able to commission the new hospital 6 months after assuming office.
You're watching the DBS 2016 Year in Review. The broadcast will continue in just a moment. Welcome back to the 2016 Year in Review on DBS Television. Concern about the suicide rate spilled over from 2015 into 2016. While health and religious leaders were discussing possible causes and the solutions to the issue, 39-year-old Norbert Leos of Kabish Babano took his own life, forcing the entire nation to ask why so many suicides appeared to be occurring in that community. An apparent spike in rape cases caused unrest among residents and led to calls for improvements in police response to sexual assault crimes.
Minister of Health and Babano MP Alvina Reynolds announced that her ministry had mapped out a major plan to help curb the problem. The initiative would include a number of training programs specifically targeted at the Babano community.
We seem to see more of the situations occurring in the Babano constituency, and as parliamentary rep, it is my role to step in and really put some measures in place to really arrest these very serious issues of life that we see happening among our young men and young women.
Well-known clinical psychologist Dr. Franklin Bray suggested that the prevalence of suicides was reflective of a deep-seated social ill and a lack of hope among the youth.
I am of the opinion that we are now beginning to realize what we have not been doing in the past. We've not been paying significant attention to our social issues, and many things are now beginning to come up that we have to pay attention to. We cannot just pay lip service to mental illness. We cannot pay lip service to our social problems or seek to find temporary first aid or band-aid for those issue, for those issues. We need to be very deliberate, very intentional in what we do.
SLP candidate for Castries South, Dr. Ernest Hilaire, called for professional intervention to help stem the tide of suicides. The government of St. Lucia also announced plans to intensify its engagement of civil society to find solutions to the rising incidence of suicides on the island. Acting Prime Minister Philip J. Pierre rejected suggestions that the suicides were largely driven by unemployment. Meanwhile, concerned church leaders organized a day of prayer in Babano to seek intervention to address the spate of suicides in that community. The Sufra Development Foundation reiterated calls for tourists to go through the right channels to plan climbs of the Pitors following the death of a 61-year-old Canadian national. Police said the Canadian national went on an unauthorized hiking expedition on Gros Pitor in Sufra, encountered difficulty, and lost consciousness. This was not the first time that someone has died after attempting to climb the Pitors. On Tuesday, March 8, 2016, a post-mortem conducted on the body of Christopher Dachuk revealed that he died as a result of a heart attack due to heart disease. A special sitting at the House of Parliament was held to acknowledge the retirement of the Director of Public Prosecutions, Victoria Charles Clark, in March. The same month, a commendation service and promotion parade was held for outgoing Police Commissioner Errol Alexander. Alexander was replaced by Sevre Morcherie. Outspoken human rights attorney Mary Francis would take issue with the manner in which the new police chief was selected. The process to identify a police chief has been mired in controversy, with an injunction being filed by one applicant to have it stopped.
I cannot understand the Public Service Commission having advertised, having received the applicants, and then withdrawing, re-advertising, and changing the terms and the conditions, and so forth. So why all this, prefabric, and what should I say? Well, uncertainty. And the Public Service Commission is supposed to be an independent body under our constitution. I'm supposed to be protected and from political interference. And to my mind, the way the appointment of the Commissioner of Police was dealt with suggests that something was not right there. And it seems to me the Public Service Commission seemed to have forgotten its mandate in terms of such appointments.
Acting Commissioner of Police Errol Alexander expressed confidence that his successor would continue to build on his accomplishments, especially when it came to restoring public confidence in the department and disciplining officers. Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony, meanwhile, gave assurances that everything was being done to identify a new Director of Public Prosecutions as well as a Deputy DPP. An EU delegation met with the Prime Minister in January and held him to a March deadline to appoint both a DPP and Deputy DPP. The delegation expressed displeasure with the Prime Minister's handling of the impacts report on investigation into alleged extrajudicial police killings. But according to Dr. Anthony, the appointment of a DPP would by no means signal the end of the impacts matter.
The issue of March came up because I suggested to the European Union that by the end of March, a director of public prosecutions will be appointed, and hopefully a deputy director. So it's never an issue that impacts will be resolved by the end of March, because that's very wrong, that's inaccurate. Can be resolved by the end of March if you're going to appoint a DPP by the end of March, who has responsibility to make a determination as to whether there will be any prosecution. So that's the first point. The method of appointing of a DPP is understood. It's not the government that appoints a director of public prosecutions or the deputy director.
The Director of Public Prosecutions and the Deputy Director are appointed by the Governor General, acting on the advice of the Judicial Legal Services Commission. The chairperson of the Judicial Legal Services Commission is the Chief Justice. What happens, though, in the case of the Director, before the Judicial Legal Services Commission advises the Governor General to appoint, they're required to consult the Prime Minister. Consulting the Prime Minister doesn't mean that they take the advice of the Prime Minister.
The entire country was shocked when Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony expressed concern that a serial rapist could be on the loose. The concern came in the wake of an alarming number of rape cases on the island.
I believe that there are one or two serial rapists in our midst. A person who rapes once and gets away with it, they're going to do it another time. They're going to do it a third time. So we need to look at this issue very, very closely, and the police need to begin to look at the incidents of rape in a very specialized and focused way. You need to get a good database of who are the individuals, the perpetrators in our midst.
The shock over the Prime Minister's statement was surpassed by news that a woman was raped in front of her one-year-old child in March, sparking national outrage. The increase of foot patrols in non-traditional areas and the review of rape cases over the previous year to determine if, in fact, there is a serial rapist on the loose were just some of the measures outlined by the National Security Minister to address mounting concern about the spike in rapes. Pressure began to be applied on the police to do more. Acting Deputy Police Commissioner Sevra Morshiri came forward to shed light on the police action plan on rape, including the establishment of a task force to deal specifically with sexual offences. The island's Health and Gender Affairs Minister went a step further by suggesting the establishment of a special court to deal with rising rape cases and other forms of violence against women. Similar courts exist in other jurisdictions. The suggestion was one recommendation coming out of a special forum held to devise strategies to address the spike in rape cases. Meanwhile, opposition leader Dr. Gail Rigobert called for the forensic lab to be reopened in order to help prosecute rapists. Dr. Rigobert said it was an indictment on the government that it had not heeded the calls of the people to have the lab opened.
You can well appreciate that the closure of the forensic lab means that evidence has to be sent overseas at a very high cost to taxpayers, to government. As you can imagine, that with every passing week, there is some criminal act that is committed requiring the thorough investigation of the police and processing of evidence. So while the lab remains closed, it means that the police has to prioritize, has to send evidence abroad. I'm told that that evidence has to be accompanied by law enforcement. It means at least that is what is required.
Dr. Rigobert called for the implementation of tangible measures by the government to deal with the increase in sexual assault cases on the island. She also expressed the belief that persons who have been charged with sexual assault should not be allowed to run for public office. Aware of the situation in St. Lucia, the Caribbean Committee Against Sex Crimes came forward to offer to partner with the government to assist in the implementation of a sex offender list or registry. The offer followed statements by Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony in support of suggestions that a sex offenders list be established. Meanwhile, a social media campaign launched in March blasted stereotypes suggesting that women's dressing may be sending the message that they are asking for sex.
In April, the island confirmed its first Zika cases, immediately giving rise to concerns from hotel owners and managers. Already, the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention had issued travel warnings about the growing Zika virus threat in the region. The fear was that if the spread of the virus picked up pace and travelers panicked, it would mean trouble for one of the island's biggest foreign exchange earners.
A 28-year-old woman and a 25-year-old man were the first confirmed cases of Zika in St. Lucia. The cases were confirmed by the Caribbean Public Health Agency, or CAFA, in Trinidad and Tobago in April. Before the end of the month, the Office of the Chief Medical Officer, CMO, would announce two additional cases of the Zika virus. The patients were both female, residing in separate locations within St. Lucia.
At this stage, as we have been doing before, we advise the public to take all of the necessary measures to reduce the breeding of mosquitoes in and around their home, and to also take the necessary personal measures to reduce the exposure to the Aedes aegypti mosquito. Because of the nature of the Zika virus disease, where 4 out of 5 persons, that is 80% of persons, do not show signs and symptoms, it is quite possible that we have in-country transmission. So although these are the cases that we have that are confirmed, there may be other cases according to what our data is indicating.
The tourism industry was immediately put on edge by the announcement, especially since the Centers for Disease Control had just issued travel notices for Caribbean destinations, many of which had confirmed cases of the mosquito-borne virus. The increase in microcephaly cases in Brazil sparked a debate on abortion and the reproductive rights of women in that country. With the confirmation of the virus in St. Lucia, a similar debate began here. In April, efforts by the Ministry of Health, along with foreign partners, to prepare the Owen King EU Hospital for its formal opening picked up pace. Work began on installing furniture and medical equipment at the facility. Several months later, there was still no word on a date for the official commissioning of the hospital. A fierce critic of the SLP government for delaying the opening of the facility, the new UWP government would face similar criticisms. The Cabinet of Ministers would tour the site in October so that members could get a better idea of the facility's readiness for commissioning. A high-level delegation from the European Union, or EU, would carry out a similar tour. The EU itself had expressed concerns about delays in the official commissioning of the facility. Prime Minister Alan Chastney would eventually meet with contractors on the project to discuss the project. Government, he had indicated, was leaning toward a partial commissioning of that facility. In April, the St. Lucia Labour Party expressed concern about more and more potentially libelous statements making their way onto political platforms and the media as the election campaign heated up. The party accused the media of focusing on the wrong issues. President of the Media Association of St. Lucia, Clinton Reynolds, took on the critics in the St. Lucia Labour Party who suggested that the media was doing them a disservice by focusing on trivial issues raised at their political meetings. Reynolds questioned whether there were even issues of consequence coming out of those meetings.
It's very interesting, you know, and even laughable, because I think they are right. They are totally correct in the sense that, you know, media report on those trivial issues. The bigger question is, why is it that media are reporting on the trivial issues? Is it because when there are political rallies and you know, you have the platform campaigning, that there is nothing substantive that the politicians discuss? And I think this is where we need to do a comprehensive review or analysis of what is going on in our local politics. If there is nothing substantive coming out of the political platforms, how do you expect media to report on substantive issues coming out of the political platforms?
UWP political leader Alan Chastney came out in support of journalists, warning them against allowing politicians to intimidate them. Interestingly, Chastney's clash with an HTS journalist some months later would find his words used against him. The political leader of the Lucian People's Movement, or LPM, also came out in defense of the media, calling a series of threats of legal action against multiple journalists and media houses a form of legal intimidation designed to silence reporters and to suppress free speech. Journalists appear divided on the issue.
They each and all seem to feel, by virtue of what they do and say, that they are cuts above many others within the media. They seem to feel that if you don't see it their way, then you're blind. You know, I'm coming up against a situation where increasingly when people don't agree with what I say, then it seems that my words and my writings and my my information, you know, is worthless and therefore ought not to be published. I'm coming up against that increasingly, the tendency not to want to agree to disagree. And that is a sorry situation.
We have made them the news. Their press release is badly written. We read all of it. There's no backstory for most of the media. We don't challenge what they write. And then, of course, you have our dependence on maybe getting invited to some stupid cocktail party that somebody else paid for, or maybe you paid for it yourself, your taxpayers' money, you know, etc. I don't go to tax to cocktails. Never have. I don't. And it's not just because I have a leg problem right now. I just have never done it. But there are journalists who can't wait to the cocktail go to cocktail parties, who can't wait for a jazz festival ticket, etc. And they want to be friendly with everybody to get that, both the guys and the girls.
Now under public scrutiny and criticism, the ruling St. Lucia Labour Party attempted to defend its record on press freedom amid claims that its members were using threats of litigation to censor and silence media critics. Former Miku North MP Janine Compton-Antoine announced she would be making another bid to represent the constituency in Parliament. In an attempt to win over a growing number of disillusioned and apathetic voters, she offered herself as the people's candidate. Compton-Antoine was hoping to break the seeming chokehold of the main political parties on the local political system by separating herself from the pack from early on. In an unprecedented move, she signed a contract with residents that would hold her accountable to deliver on the contents of that document or face removal.
Should Janine fail to fulfill her obligation herein, the people may choose to hold her accountable and demand performance of this contract.
A US $120 million project, which was expected to create over 1,000 jobs, became the first project to be officially approved under the Citizenship by Investment Program, or CIP, which was launched in January. The Belvedere Plantation, which would be constructed by the Boka Estate Limited, was expected to bring in significant revenue to the island.
400 jobs during construction, 800 jobs following final completion, and of course that is an economic benefit not just to the investors and owners of the hotel that we're going to build, but also to those who work with us and their families. So it is a very important step.
The UWP's political leader, Alan Chastney, continued to express reservations about the Citizenship by Investment program. Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony had sold the program on its ability to help the country overcome ongoing economic troubles. But the opposition party was concerned about due diligence procedures.
And let's not forget that the public of St. Lucia were not even given the opportunity to have seen the regulations. The regulations were announced that night and then told to St. Lucians as a fait accompli afterwards. And so here was a government that started a process in which the opposition was included when it came to the legislation, but when it came to the regulations, the opposition was nowhere to be found.
In May, Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony would give in to opposition pressure to call an early election and announce a date for the poll. It would signal the start of a brief but intense campaign with no shortage of drama, from allegations of sexual harassment by candidates to the media being chided for focusing too much on the drama and not enough on the issues. The media was criticized for its coverage of rape cases, while the police were lambasted for not providing officers with sufficient training to deal with sexual assault cases, as well as their poor rape conviction record. The arrest of a group of women at a popular nightclub gave rise to debates about everything, from free movement of CARICOM citizens for work to the legalization of prostitution.
14 female non-nationals arrested at a strip club in May sparked a national debate on a range of issues, from the free movement of CARICOM citizens to the legalization of sex work. Former Gender Relations Minister Sarah Flood-Bobre reacted to the arrest, calling for more gainful employment opportunities for women. According to Flood-Bobre's logic, the lack of jobs and low wages were forcing some women into the sex trade. The statement was met by a call from a human rights advocate for prostitution to be legalized. According to Felicia Brown, the criminalization of the practice has not helped to eradicate it, but instead had driven it underground, putting the women who engage in it at risk. Human rights attorney Mary Francis had a different take. She saw some legal conflicts the case could present. The women were arrested for working without the requisite permits, but Mary Francis questioned the exact nature of the work they were involved in. She was concerned that it could open up a legal can of worms.
What type of work? When you're charged for working without a work permit, what type is this recognized work? If they were supposed to be a striptease girl, I do not know whether such work is sanctioned as legitimate occupation, legitimate work according to our law. So all those things seem to puzzle me, and there seem to be ambiguities in all those things.
For Gender Affairs Minister Alvina Reynolds, the solution was educating and empowering women and girls to help them escape and stay out of prostitution.
When it comes to employment, that is a bit shady. And especially if what the person is told will be the contract, and when they get into the country, be it overseas or in Asia, it does not hold. This is a cause for concern. And of course, I know it's just like drug trafficking, okay, where persons are forced. And unfortunately, it's the vulnerable persons who are always caught, you know, because they are the ones in the front line.
In May, the president of the Media Association of St. Lucia made a case for insurance coverage for journalists and media workers after a spate of threats against media personnel. According to Clinton Reynolds, it was one way of recognizing the danger journalists are exposed to and the sacrifices of practitioners. The call by Reynolds came one day after veteran broadcaster Sam Flood had a threat made against his life. Newspaper publisher and talk show host Rick Wayne got a similar threat on live television on the week before. Police said they were taking the threats seriously. Under the criminal code, everyone commits an offense who, in any manner, knowingly utters, conveys, or causes any person to receive a threat to cause death or bodily harm to any person.
Monsieur Bad Boy, Tamadusa, Sue Flabo, Gain. British warship will have to come in the harbor there.
It's what?
A British warship will have to come in the harbor. Because there'll be civil unrest. When if he's used, got a pass, Jimmy Pali, Manuka Palila.
A similar threat was made against the former host of Newsmaker Live, Laura Japier, last year. Meanwhile, veteran journalist Rick Wayne shrugged off the threats made against him by a caller to his TV talk show. Wayne was accused of being part of efforts to return the United Workers Party to power. If that happened, he was told, he would pay with his life. Talk show host Laura Japier had a similar threat made against her on live TV, while reporters and cameramen had made several reports of threats being issued by gang members at various crime scenes being covered by the journalists. The subject of rape was forced back into the spotlight after the sexual assault of a group of teens in the heart of the city. The incident reportedly happened at the Derek Walcott Square. Two teenage boys were reportedly held at gunpoint and forced to perform sex acts on their female companions before their assailants assaulted the young women.
After a while, a guy passed in a, he had a black cap and a red t-shirt, a red polo shirt. He said, he just passing. So I wonder why he said he just passing. So he asking us if we were having sex under the tent, because where we were sitting is like the tent is covered around, so we're sitting flat down. He asking us if we're having sex and that, and so we make him know, well, no, we're just having funny. And as he can hear, we are talking out loud. So he said, okay, do our thing. And he made the run around the fountain. They had two other guys with him, and they made the run around the fountain, and they go. So after 45 minutes, I saw the shadow coming to enter the tent, and my friend knocking me, telling me, get up. Yeah, and while I get up, is when I get up and I see him with the gun. And I was shocked. In the stand I stand, he ended up knocking me to my head with the gun. Yeah, and that's when I fell down. I remember he said, like, I just don't remember, like, I don't really remember what he said, because in the knock I get in my head, I was kind of out for a while. So maybe the girls can explain the rest too. So yeah.
Okay, did you all like
Did they force you all to have relations?
Yeah, he forced us to have sex with them, and he forced us to have oral sex and sex with them before he had sex with them, and then he had oral sex and then he had sex with them.
Leader of the opposition, Dr. Gail Rigobert, called on the government to plug the loopholes in the system that were emboldening criminals to commit such acts.
Well, if the rumors are true, which suggest that the perpetrators themselves are alluding to the loopholes within the judicial system and are relatively confident that they will go undetected, that's frightening. That's frightening. And that is why over the last couple of months, over the last year and a half, we have been agitating. I have been agitating for the reopening of the forensic lab, for the establishment of an entity that is well outfitted to deal with crimes of this nature. And that is why we welcome the news from the Royal St. Lucia Police Force that not only would they embellish the vulnerable persons unit, that they would also set up a special entity to deal specifically with rape-related matters or matters of sexual assault.
Local advocacy group Speak Out St. Lucia called on the City Council to look into improving the lighting and security around the Derek Walcott Square. The teen rape led the former president of the Principals Association to call on young people to be more vigilant and aware of their surroundings. The victims of the Derek Walcott Square incident were only the latest adolescents to be assaulted. Two 16-year-olds were gang raped in Rodney Bay in November last year. Meanwhile, human rights group United and Strong said it had enough of the lip service being paid to the issue of rape and called on the police and government to come up with concrete solutions to the problem. Police responded by saying they were committed to bringing rapists, like all other criminals, to justice. This after criticisms that the majority of rapes were unreported and that the vast majority of reported rapes never lead to arrests. The police department outlined how it planned to deal with rape reports in the face of limited resources. National Security Minister Victor Lacorbiniere came under pressure from the talk show host for his reaction to the incident. The sexual assault victims advocacy group Speak Out St. Lucia joined those expressing displeasure with the minister's statements. Lacorbiniere was taken to task for what some saw as his insensitive response to a question about the city rape. There were renewed calls for the establishment of a sex offenders registry to be fast-tracked. With election fever picking up, questions about the political future of Castries Central MP Richard Frederick abounded. Rumors were rife that he would run as an independent candidate, having fallen out with the UWP. If he did, it would not be the first time. Frederick was elected as MP for Castries Central as an independent candidate during a by-election in 2006. He eventually joined the UWP but was expelled after a very public rift with the political leader Alan Chiasney. Frederick appeared to be unsure if he would contest the seat. At a meeting at the Castries Town Hall, he put the question to his audience, who seemed to be in unanimous agreement that he should run, but the final decision would have to be Frederick's. Frederick shrugged off suggestions that his chances of winning the Castries Central seat have dwindled since his expulsion from the United Workers' Party over differences with the political leader. The opposition United Workers' Party chose one of its political meetings on the William Peter Boulevard to respond to the government's estimate of revenue and expenditure after being noticeably absent from Parliament when the document was tabled. The year before, the debate ended prematurely after the opposition failed to speak. It later denied walking out on the debate and defended its position not to start the budget debate. The party repeated calls for early elections and went as far as presenting its own date, June 27th, for the next general election.
And let us all come together under the leadership of the United Workers' Party and help rebuild this country and make this country the country we have always known it to be, the country of St. Lucia, under the guidance of the United Workers' Party. I want to thank you very much. I want to wish you the very best. And may God bless you as we prepare for the next general election. And in closing, I want to say, the fact that they have run out of town tonight, I am giving you the date for election. Election will be on the 27th of June. You prepared, put your house in order, and let's move on. I thank you.
It was in May that UWP leader Alan Chastney introduced his five-point plan that he said was guaranteed to ease the financial strain put on the backs of citizens, but what he saw as oppressive Labour government policies.
It cannot be that the one thing that we've struggled so long to do, which is to own our own house, and that after paying a mortgage for so many years, that a government would come and impose a property tax and cause us to lose our home. That is not the St. Lucian way. That is not the United Workers' Party way. And it too must go.
Deputy Prime Minister Philip J. Pierre dismissed Mr. Chastney's five-point plan, especially his planned reduction and eventual removal of VAT. He called the plan irrational and impractical.
Mr. Chastney was part of a cabinet in between 2006 and 2011 that approved the VAT. If you look in the budget statement or you look at the reports from the IMF, these reports will tell you that the United Workers Party agreed to implement VAT. They agreed. The whole VAT infrastructure was set up during the time of the United Workers Party when Mr. Chastney was a minister in the cabinet. So to come now and have us turn around and say you're going to eliminate VAT or reduce it is manifestly not right, because you have to see where you're going to get the revenue from.
The opposition repeatedly accused the Labour administration of trying to tax its way out of a fiscal deficit. It blamed the 15% VAT rate for the contraction of the economy and higher prices for goods and services. The United Workers' Party was counting on voters to give the party a resounding mandate after it released its prescription for fixing what it considered the ruling party's economic blunders. The SLP would reveal its own plans to resuscitate the economy, but United Workers' Party would brand Prime Minister Dr. Kenny Anthony a copycat, accusing him of replicating its five-point economic recovery plan and presenting a 15-point plan of his own. According to the UWP, it was a plan he would never be able to deliver on.
So he knows that the Labour Party does not have a following. So he uses all kinds of tricks to attract people to come to his meeting for him to say he has a big crowd. But what he has to do is call elections and he'll find out how much of a crowd he would have voting for him on election day. So I know for a fact that the plans of the UWP will work. We have a leader who is capable. And I want to tell them further, for those who question his ability to lead, check the returns on investment. Mr. Alan Chastney, as Minister of Tourism, spent an extra $125 million in the tourism sector.
Through a series of planned press conferences, the ruling St. Lucia Labour Party began elaborating on its 15-point plan. The plan was dismissed by some, but the party remained adamant that more than just a list of election promises, the plan was a realistic one that would be delivered. And then the Prime Minister dropped the bomb. In an address to the nation, Dr. Kenny Anthony announced June 6 as the date for general elections. In a press release immediately after the announcement, the United Workers Party welcomed the announcement, saying it was settled and perfectly poised to win the election. But at a press conference later that same day, the party seemed to take issue with the date of the elections and cited several reasons the date could cause problems. There were issues with the voters' list and the fact that the elections coincided with the writing of CXC exams.
This time around, all the factors are coming together to ensure that the party is ready at the polls. It is a fact that the SLP has been a national disaster. That every initiative has been at a devastating cost to the people of St. Lucia, whether it be the rich, poor, or middle class. The SLP has failed to bring transparency, accountability, growth, jobs, and has failed on almost every other election promise they have made. The SLP is a lesson on how destructive a bad government can be. They are a disaster of a government led by a delusional prime minister.
The National Students' Council was also concerned about how the election would affect CXC examinations, which would be held at locations which would be doubling as examination halls and polling stations. And then there was the row about the date of nomination day. The United Workers' Party took issue with the Prime Minister's decision to set Saturday, May 28th as nomination day. The UWP was concerned about what this would mean for persons who observed Saturday as their Sabbath. The party also said it was not constitutional. The UWP said it stood ready to take legal action.
So we contend that there has been a procedural error, a miscalculation that needs to be corrected. And we contend that Nominations Day cannot be on the 28th and ought to be on Monday, the 30th. And if in fact that is agreed to, it means that elections cannot be held on June 6th. And maybe what everybody has suspected all along, that this haste in which the Prime Minister is moving and his fixation on the date of June 6th, which I myself, and I believe many other solutions, find confusing, cannot be.
Chairman of the St. Lucia Labour Party, Claudius Francis, was adamant that the Prime Minister did not breach the Elections Act with his choice of election date or nomination day. The UWP's Castries South East candidate, Guy Joseph, refused to participate in nomination day activities on religious grounds. The United Workers' Party went further and challenged SLP Castries South East candidate Joachim Henry, also a Seventh-day Adventist, to break his silence on the nomination day issue, and he did, but he didn't say what they hoped he would.
As far as the law is concerned, you do not have to. You understand? You could make the prior arrangements, you could get somebody else to fall in for you. As a Seventh-day Adventist, I've been a Seventh-day Adventist and a Sabbath keeper all my life. However, the issues of Sabbath keeping from time to time within a society that is not a Sabbath keeping society, we are always confronted with issues, and it will always be a continuous debate. It's always easy to try to show somebody's fault, and this was classical among the Pharisees in Christ's time. They noticed that he was picking corn on the Sabbath and he was accused. They noticed he was doing something. He always referred to them as hypocrites, because it was never because they were concerned about holiness. It's because they were concerned about trying to show fault on somebody else. If my opponent looks at himself carefully and what he says after, I have difficulty that he will speak about the Sabbath in that manner. If he's going to lie about the Prime Minister giving me $1.2 million to campaign. If you want holiness, if you want righteousness, you should always be righteous in your doing and in your speaking.
Former Agriculture Minister and UWP candidate for Babano, Ezekiel Joseph, threatened legal action against independent candidate for Miku North, Jeanine Compton Antoine, following claims by Compton Antoine that she was sexually harassed by her colleague politician.
And I am talking to the man, and the man is chatting me. So I'm wondering what is going on. So I keep telling him, let us talk about Miku North and the farmers and all the problems that they have. He keeps coming back to the same topic. When I saw that nothing was happening, I said, I will leave now. I got up to leave. This is in the Ministry of Agriculture, the government buildings. The man grabbed me. He tried to take off my shirt and tried to kiss me. And you're telling me that I must stay with people like that?
Joseph dismissed the allegation as a political ploy to spoil his chances of winning the Babano seat.
I'm aware of that type of intention that was in the making. The reality is that I was approached by someone from Fawaso who told me that there are some plans to try and identify a young lady in Fawaso who would make a statement saying that I raped her and I took arrangements with her mother. Unfortunately, the young lady declined to make that statement. So when I heard Janine making made that statement, in fact, I have not heard the full text of Janine's statement, but when I read on St. Lucia News Online and she said that she came to my office and I grabbed her hands and I tore her clothes and I tried to kiss her, that's a big joke.
UWP candidate for Castries Central, Sarah Flood Bober, reacted by saying the allegation against Joseph should not be taken lightly. Meanwhile, women's rights advocate Felicia Brown cautioned against a rush to judgment. The issue would not resurface during the election campaign, but in July, former Gender Affairs Minister Alvina Reynolds would bring it up. According to Reynolds, the issue had not been adequately addressed by the ruling party or the accused in the case. Neither one responded to her statement.
Please stay with us because the Year in Review 2016 will continue in just a bit. Thank you so much for staying with us. You're watching the DBS Year in Review 2016. In June, St. Lucia swore in a new prime minister in the person of Mr. Alan Chastney. After a brief but hard-fought campaign, Mr. Chastney denied Dr. Kenny Anthony and the SLP a second consecutive term in office. The UWP won 11 of the 17 constituencies and forced Dr. Anthony into an early political grave.
With elections just days away, there were concerns being expressed about what was described as the island's reluctance to invite election observers to observe the poll. The concern was being raised by the opposition UWP and the International Democratic Union. The organization on its website said that this seeming unwillingness validated allegations that the government was attempting to manipulate the election process, suggestions that the government called unfortunate.
Well, you know, the great news is we've had a very clear plan. The party has always been ready, and the plan is being executed extremely well. We're now left to the latter part of the plan, which is on the day execution. So getting the voters out, making sure that people who've moved from one polling division to another, that we help those people. To ensure that our inside agents all clearly understand the rules. So even if somebody is on the voters list but don't have any ID, they still can vote. Once there are people in there to be able to swear that they know that person. That people who we don't believe should have been on the list and we've not been able to determine whether they actually live in the constituency to file an objection. So it cannot prevent them from voting, but clearly it starts building up evidence if in fact anything goes wrong, because you know it's unprecedented in the history of St. Lucia that we now don't have any international observers here. So there's no third party entity that's going to be observing it. So it means that more of the responsibility is going to be put on the party to be able to be its own observer and to be very acquainted with the laws and make sure that we ensure that this process is as free and fair as possible.
It was later announced that observer missions from the United States, the UK and the EU would be here to monitor the general elections. A member of the Electoral Commission still questioned why they had to ask to monitor the election and weren't invited by the government. Meanwhile, the opposition claimed that there were irregularities on the updated voters list. There were claims that at least 1,200 people registered in Castries South East residents lived in other constituencies. Political parties launched their respective manifestos at political meetings, with speakers elaborating on key sections of the documents which outlined the party's policies, intentions and ideology on critical issues. The document were also made available online mere days before the election. The Caribbean Development Research Services, the authors of the poll that put the two main political parties in a substantial dead heat leading into the election was forced to defend its findings. The ruling SLP challenged the findings of the survey and announced that its own polls had found that the SLP is firmly in sight of an election victory. Surprisingly, UWP political leader Alan Chastney came out to say he wasn't putting too much faith in the Carter's political opinion poll either. Police, fire and correctional officers headed to the polls early. They would be joined by patients and clients of the various hospitals and care facilities around the island. Leave has also been cancelled for all police officers from 6 p.m. Sunday, June 5, 2016 until 8 a.m. Tuesday, June 7, 2016. The number of political meetings being held by political parties multiplied rapidly. The meetings attract citizens in the hundreds. The opposition, UWP in particular, was under pressure to attract support for its candidates, especially the political novices. While parties were expectedly confident of seats in certain areas, others were less certain, and there were some key bellwether constituencies where the outcomes would give an indication of which way the national picture was going. With that in mind, a lot of eyes were focused on the Mikud South constituency, where UWP political leader Alan Chastney was ruling against the SLP Gibeon Ferdinand.
Tomorrow is the launching of Gibeon Ferdinand. Gibeon Ferdinand is the Sinusha Labour Party's candidate for Mikud South. He's a candidate that we are very excited about. He's a candidate we have a lot of confidence in. He is very much connected to the people of Mikud South. And since he was announced by the Prime Minister at the launching of Brother Joachim Henry, he has been on the ground, he has been mobilizing, he has been meeting people, he has been hosting activities. We begin at 5 p.m. tomorrow, and the activity will be held at the Deriso playing field. We expect that it will be a mammoth crowd. I believe it is expected to be the largest activity in terms of attendance that we have had so far. Many persons are excited about it, and there are various reasons people are excited about Mikud South. Our candidate is a man who is very well loved in his constituency. He is very much connected to the people of Mikud South. He is someone that they are very proud of.
Chastney would win that seat and his party the election. Alan Chastney was sworn in as Prime Minister after denying Kenny Anthony and the SLP a second consecutive term in office. After a very brief campaign, results from the June 6 general election had the UWP winning 11 of the 17 constituencies. The chairman of the UWP, however, called for a recount of votes in two key constituencies, Castries South and Denry North. There were 21 ballot boxes from Castries South and 20 from Denry North to be recounted.
I want to thank all the voters who turned out in such large numbers to vote on behalf of the party. The recounts have been done and the results remain the same. We have been advised. The way forward for the party, we will continue to strengthen the party and build the party. The work that was started has to continue.
A recount of the ballots was done for three constituencies, and the Electoral Department announced that the results would stand, with the UWP winning 11 of the 17 seats. A former chairman of the United Workers' Party accused the governing SLP of underestimating the opposition party. Ezekiel Joseph said rumors of deep-seated division in the organization were grossly exaggerated, especially by the Labour Party, which used the perceived division as a campaign tool.
I've always said that we don't have divisions. It's a perception of the St. Lucia Labour Party. We have different of opinions, and there's nothing wrong in an organization where persons are expressing their opinion, right? The difference between the St. Lucia Labour Party and the United Workers Party is that you have the opportunity to express your opinion, right? And that is the difference, and that's what has caused us to win the election, because we have grown as a party, we have gelled as a party, we know each other, and we know what we like and what we dislike.
The speculations about division were fueled by a very public statement by several senior UWP officials criticizing political leader Alan Chasney and his leadership style. The new United Workers' Party government announced that handling the impacts report on investigations into extrajudicial police killings was a priority. The United States and EU governments had repeatedly called on the St. Lucia government to act on the findings of the report. The U.S. had gone as far as withholding assistance to the local police force until the matter was resolved. The new government promised to take action on the report within the first 100 days in office.
We did say that within the first 100 days of us coming into power, we would be dealing with the impacts, because this has been a very contentious issue. Yesterday, after the swearing-in, the Prime Minister, the Commissioner of Police, the incoming designated Minister of National Security, and myself, we met and discussed a number of issues. And certainly impacts is number high up on the agenda. We have said that we're going to be putting in a commission to deal with impacts. We'll look at maybe a three-man commission of maybe retired judges or magistrates to review the whole impact situation and advise us on the way forward.
Members of St. Lucia's new government were sworn in on June 14th. The new cabinet of ministers included several former government ministers, a former prime minister, and three newcomers. Thousands of St. Lucians thronged to the Philip Marsley grounds in VA4 to witness the swearing in. Also in attendance were several regional dignitaries, including Prime Minister of St. Vincent, Dr. James Mitchell, and Timothy Harris, Prime Minister of St. Kitts Nevis. Noticeably absent from the list of ministers, although not from the proceedings, was Castries Central Representative Sarah Flood Beaubrun. This led to immediate and widespread speculation over the reasons for her not being given a portfolio, especially after her resounding defeat over the opponents at the general elections. The United Workers' Party would put an end to speculation about the role of the Castries Central Representative Sarah Flood Beaubrun. During an appearance on Newsmaker Live, a UWP spokesperson explained that the party had other plans for Mrs. Flood Beaubrun. She explained that the MP would be held in reserve to serve as a deputy speaker of the House if the opposition failed to nominate one. Prime Minister Alan Chasney, meanwhile, had to defend his decision to have what he termed as clusters of ministers serving in key ministries. While the new configuration reduced the number of ministries, it did not lessen the number of ministerial appointments.
Well, we have actually less ministers than we had last time. And as time goes by and then the government takes the form of this new structure, we'll then start seeing the cost savings. But more importantly, I'm hoping that we're going to see greater efficiency.
The debate over the constitution of the new cabinet coincided with the release of the paper by former diplomat Earl Huntley entitled Constitutional Reform in St. Lucia, Bridging the Divides in the Debate. The paper proposed a new method of selecting the cabinet of ministers whose size would be limited by the constitution. He suggested that there should only be 10 ministries headed by 10 ministers.
My paper is proposing 10, but it proposes between 8 and 10, really. So in that regard, we are on the same wavelength. It's just that in my paper, if you had 8 ministries or 10 ministries, you'd have 8 ministers. In fact, the paper says 9 plus the prime ministers. You have 10 ministers. So 10 ministries.
Barely a week into office, the new UWP government was forced to seek advice on its legal options to deal with the renewal of the contracts for several key persons by the previous administration. The new attaché to the Prime Minister claimed that this was done just before general elections and that some of the contracts were for up to 3 years.
We now have a situation where you have an attorney general who's been appointed on a long-term basis. You have some ambassadors who are also appointed on a long-term basis. So these contracts, we're looking into all of them to review them and to see what is it that we can do as a government in terms of ensuring that we can move forward. It is a little bit uncomfortable, you would imagine, that you're coming in as an administration and some of the positions were political appointments. These were persons who were with political affiliations.
There had been speculation about the reason for the delay in announcing a new attorney general, but according to Charles, the Attorney General's contract was one of those repeatedly negotiated before the election. The new administration was concerned about the financial implications for the country as well as its ability to govern effectively. In June, the UK voted to leave the EU, causing widespread concern about the likely implications for the region. The Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies suggested that Britain's decision to leave the EU would adversely affect every aspect of Caribbean life. He has called on CARICOM heads to begin work on the strategic region response. Sir Hilary Beckles said the decision posed both a short-term as well as a long-term threat to the performance of CARICOM economies and should have triggered immediate strategic regional reactions. Former Prime Minister Dr. Vaughan Lewis called on the St. Lucia government to strengthen relationships with other EU member states in the wake of the UK's decision to leave the European Union. He also encouraged the development of relationships with other international partners that could cushion any potential fallout.
I think that diplomacy now suggests that we put a greater effort into dealing and ensuring our connection, new connections with Europe itself. A number of countries that are small countries and larger countries, all of them have a vote. And I believe that our diplomacy has to go in that direction. We will have to wait and see what that all of this means for the EU-ACP agreement. Because Britain, if things remain as they are, Britain is not a party in a sense to it. It's certainly not an enthusiastic party to it.
Agriculture Minister Ezekiel Joseph, meanwhile, expressed the view that the Brexit vote could open the way for increased opportunities for the banana industry.
Well, I don't believe preferential treatment. I think that we now would need to really go and speak with the present, the existing government in England, because now, based on the challenges we had, it was handed down from the EU. Now with England moving away from the EU, I can see, and that's my personal view, I can see opportunities for us, right? Not only in the question of agriculture and bananas, but other areas. And we all know of the commitment that England have as far as St. Lucia is concerned. And as a government, I can see that we have gotten a lot of support from the existing government in England, so I'm sure they'll be more accommodating as far as we are concerned.
Former High Commissioner was similarly optimistic. The Brexit vote, Dr. Ernest Healey said, had created tremendous economic uncertainty in St. Lucia, as in many other parts of the world, but he said it also presented some opportunities.
So one is not sure exactly what is going to happen. Critical will be the terms and conditions under which United Kingdom leaves the EU. And you would have heard only this morning statements coming out of, you know, the EU that they're not going to be very accommodating. I mean, they were making the point that there is no a la carte common market. In other words, you cannot cherry pick what you want, take all the good and leave behind all the bad. And presently there does not seem to be an appetite to allow the United Kingdom to come out, you know, the better for it. And of course you can understand why, because once that happens, it might encourage other countries that are, you know, thinking about whether or not the EU is for the benefit, that they too can leave, get all the goodies and leave behind all the challenges.
With Dr. Kenny Anthony bowling out of elective politics, attention turned to the leadership of the St. Lucia Labour Party and who would head the organization. Castries South MP Dr. Ernest Healey, widely tipped to be Dr. Anthony's replacement, continued to downplay the suggestions. The position was held by Philip Pierre, who assumed the role after Dr. Kenny Anthony stepped down after his election defeat. There were those who thought that Pierre was unsuited for the position and that Hile could do a better job of rebuilding the party after its June 6th thrashing at the polls. However, Pierre would be confirmed to the position at the party's convention later in the year. He was unopposed.
In July, the number of Zika infections climbed, and so did the number of pregnant women with the virus. The reality of governance set in for the new administration and the criticism of its decisions and policies began. Barely in office for a month, Prime Minister Alan Chastney was being called upon to step down. The Eastern Caribbean Court of Appeal reinstated a breach of trust, misfeasance claim against him. He also found himself in an awkward position, with the woman behind the case now serving as his attorney general. The carnival celebrations came to a tragic end, and the Saudi billionaire at the center of a major political controversy passed away, leaving doubts about whether a promised diabetes research facility here would ever materialize.
In July, doctors announced that they were monitoring four pregnant women with confirmed Zika virus infections. The Ministry of Health said it had noted a rapid increase in the number of cases of the virus, but that its focus had shifted to diagnosing and protecting pregnant women.
We also know that Zika virus comes with complications such as the microcephaly, which is the small head, and the Guillain-Barré syndrome. So our focus now is on identifying these pregnant women who present with the signs and symptoms of the Zika virus, ensuring that these women are tested to confirm the presence of Zika virus, as well as individuals who present with the complications, the Guillain-Barré, as well as babies born with microcephaly.
A month before, the ministry had confirmed an additional four cases of Zika, bringing the total number of infections to eight. At the time, it said it suspected that because of the asymptomatic nature of the virus, the actual number of infected persons was significantly higher. For months, the Ministry of Health had been working to delay what it felt was the inevitable arrival of the virus on the island. With several confirmed cases now, its focus shifted to containment. The ministry amped up its campaign to reduce mosquito breeding grounds and even partnered with local pest control company FDL to undertake a pilot project in communities with high mosquito indices. The St. Lucia Hotel and Tourism Association was doing its part to get rid of the mosquito. The Caribbean Tourism Organization and other regional tourism interests were very concerned about the potential impact of the virus on the vital tourism sector. The Eastern Caribbean Court of Appeal reinstated a breach of trust misfeasance claim against newly elected Prime Minister Alan Chastney in July. The action had previously been struck out, but that ruling was overturned. Chastney was accused of using public funds for the unlawful purpose of a political campaign. Interestingly, the woman behind the claim, Attorney General Kim St. Rose, remained in office, her contract having been renewed by the previous administration. Prime Minister Chastney said the Court of Appeal ruling put him in an awkward position, but he insisted that the allegations against him were politically motivated.
I obviously do believe it was politically motivated. That when you look at how much money was spent to reclaim what they say is $38,000, and it's not really even $38,000 because the stage, the light, and the sound was already erected. There was an opening ceremony for the lights. Following that, there was a public meeting, of which the public meeting used the same stage lights and sound. And then there was the Third World Concert, of which I paid for their transportation to get to St. Lucia, I paid for their stay in their hotel, I paid for their ground transportation, and I paid for their fees. The only thing that the town council allowed was to allow them to use the same stage lights and sounds that were already erected, and they paid for the catering, which was $2,200. And the fact is that they performed to a free concert. Nobody had to pay to be able to come to the concert.
There were several calls for political appointees under the previous administration to resign as a matter of integrity. The Attorney General was asked to do the same.
When I say a convention, I mean if you're a political appointment, the normal thing to do is a new administration comes in, you resign as a matter of integrity, as a matter of political practicality, so that things can work. Conventions operate like the oil to wheel, or the oil which helps the wheels of government to actually move smoothly. As I can make an analogy, with the Brexit situation when Cameron lost on the referendum, he immediately resigned. These are conventions. When, I mean, something happened, I mean to say, which actually causes an embarrassment, you resign.
Meanwhile, there were others who felt it was the Prime Minister who needed to step down in light of the development. Journalist and talk show host Rick Wayne would come to his defense.
There is not one person who does not know what exactly the relationship is between the Prime Minister of St. Lucia, the Labour Party, and Alan Shastny. His own words that he was waging war, his party versus Alan Shastny and Michael Shastny. So right away, the public mind is poisoned. Right away, it occurs to us again that politicians are supposed to be leaders and should not be setting up lousy examples.
The first session of the 11th Parliament was convened in July, and there was no shortage of excitement. At that sitting, members of the House of Assembly and members of the Senate met to take their respective oaths of allegiance and to be sworn in as members of Parliament. As expected, there was a standoff between the government and opposition when it came to the election of a deputy speaker. But there was as much tension outside the House as there was inside. There was a tense moment in the House of Assembly when the newly appointed speaker attempted to get a nominee for the post of deputy speaker. The scenario played out as expected, with neither the government nor opposition sides budging. The opposition had indicated from early on that it thought nominating a deputy from its ranks would not be to its advantage, while the ruling UWP had reserved the Castries Central MP Sarah Flood Bobra for the position in the event things played out as they did that day. But the issue of the deputy speaker would be far from over. As it turns out, Deputy Speaker Sarah Flood Bobra would step down not long after in order to accept a ministerial portfolio. The opposition SLP said it would be referring to the Constitution to see what it had to say on the developments in the House of Assembly. Subsequent sittings failed to elect a deputy, and the opposition announced its intention to take legal action to bring the matter to an end. Scores of sleep-deprived party lovers took to the streets of the capital for the traditional Jouvet or Daybreak jump-up, signaling the official start of the two-day carnival-costumed band parade and the end of the carnival season. Carnival revelers came out in full display on Carnival Monday. Participants waved, danced, and gyrated as they showed off the color, revelry, culture, and art of St. Lucia Carnival. The carnival bands showed off their costumes to the judges to compete for the coveted prize of Band of the Year. 11 carnival bands were registered to participate in Lucian Carnival 2016, with an average of 6,000 registered costumed revelers expected to hit the streets for the two-day jump-up, which ended on July 19th. The Labri Steel Orchestra was named the 2016 Panorama Champions, the first time that a band from the South had won the competition, which is traditionally dominated by the Castries-based orchestras. Minelle was crowned the new Calypso Monarch. She was able to defeat reigning monarch Wally to capture the crown for a fourth time. Arthur, meanwhile, captured the groovy soca monarch for a third time, while Alaman managed to capture the power soca crown. Carnival activities closed on a sad and tragic note, with two lives being lost within 24 hours, one of them a popular band leader. A deadly three-car collision on the Millennium Highway claimed the life of well-known banker Andy Delmar, the managing director of First National Bank. He was also the band leader of the Just for Fun Carnival Band. Within hours of Delmar's death, a car plunged into the Castries Harbour, claiming the life of Tanza Campbell. The other occupant of that vehicle was able to survive the crash, but concerned citizens who attempted to rescue Campbell were unsuccessful. Meanwhile, the family of 30-year-old Tanza Campbell would get some closure after a post-mortem examination confirmed that she had in fact drowned after her car spun out of control and wound up submerged in the Castries Harbour. The carnival band that Andy Delmar led paid tribute to his memory in the final hours of the two-day carnival parade. The staff of the First National Bank where Delmar worked attempted to keep the financial institution functioning with some degree of normalcy after losing its managing director. Tributes would pour in from across the region as news of his tragic passing spread. Saudi billionaire Waleed Jafali died in July, just 2 weeks after his supermodel ex-wife was awarded £75 million in a high court divorce settlement. The international businessman passed away in Zurich following a lengthy battle with cancer. His appointment as the island's representative to the International Maritime Organization became a central factor in his divorce, as well as exchanges between ruling and opposition parties here in St. Lucia. It now remains to be seen if a diabetic research facility promised by the billionaire will materialize.
News of a multi-billion US dollar project for VA4 came out in August, sparking public concern about the likely environmental impact. The opposition SLP, during whose term the project had been negotiated, was run down for its silence during the negotiation process. Now in opposition, it was full of criticisms of the project. Crime against city businesses seemed to be at an all-time high, putting the police under pressure to handle the situation as well as the accompanying gun violence. August also saw the hosting of the historic Olympic Games in Rio and high jump star Laverne Spencer making history of her own by becoming the first local athlete to reach an Olympic final.
It was in August that St. Lucians learned of the multi-million dollar development planned for the south of the island, negotiated between the SLP administration and the Hong Kong registered investment firm Desert Star Holdings. Now in opposition, the St. Lucia Labour Party was expressing concern about the environmental and other implications of the project if the new government allowed it to go through. The more than $2 billion US dollar agreement between the government of St. Lucia and Desert Star Holdings would comprise of a marina, a racecourse, a resort and shopping mall complex, casino, free trade zone, extensive entertainment and leisure facilities, as well as villas and apartments. The government sought to put to rest some of the concerns about the $2.6 billion US dollar project, which had become known as the Pearl of the Caribbean.
The agreement is in general terms a commitment on the part of the government to provide the policy, regulatory and administrative framework within which the project could be implemented. Nothing in the agreement purports to guarantee the investor any license, approvals, or other concessions without due process. Indeed, every undertaking in the agreement is limited to the requirements of the relevant legislation.
A team from Invest St. Lucia, along with the minister with responsibility for investment and commerce, visited the proposed site for the Desert Star Holdings project in order to learn firsthand some of the concerns that groups like the National Trust had about the likely environmental impact of the project. The St. Lucia National Trust, meanwhile, despite being part of the initial discussions on the proposed Pearl of the Caribbean development, still had concerns about certain aspects of the project. Chief among them was the inclusion of the Makote mangrove within the project boundaries and the related environmental and socioeconomic dislocation it could cause. Eventually, the developer would relent and exclude the mangrove from the proposed development. The 2016 Summer Olympic, officially known as the Games of the 31st Olympiad and commonly known as Rio 2016, got underway in August. Athletes from hundreds of countries assembled in Brazil to compete in a variety of sporting disciplines, among them a five-member team from St. Lucia. The island was represented in swimming, high jump, track and field, and sailing. Back home, the Ministry of Sport teamed up with local designer to create an Olympic flag t-shirt, which would become the centerpiece of a campaign to get St. Lucians to rally behind their Olympic athletes. The Rio Games were the first to be held in South America, but were historic for other reasons as well. St. Lucia's high jumper Laverne Spencer would also make history by becoming the first St. Lucian athlete to qualify for an Olympic final. Spencer cleared each of her five jumps to earn the right to compete in the final round on Saturday, August 20th. The entire country was glued to the television sets that Saturday when Spencer took to the field at Rio Olympics, her third Olympic Games. Scores of St. Lucians also crammed into the Derek Walcott Square to watch the local athlete take on 16 of the best in the world in an attempt to capture the coveted Olympic gold. Sadly, it would not happen. Spencer's failure to even jump on two occasions, choosing instead to duck under the bar, left many disappointed and confused by the athlete's actions. But despite not medaling at Rio Olympics, Laverne Spencer was celebrated for her accomplishments at the Games. Spencer was the first St. Lucian athlete to make the final of an Olympic game and placed sixth overall among 16 jumpers. Spencer would return home to a hero's welcome. She would spend the next several weeks being feted and carrying out speaking engagements at schools around the island. It was also in August that the West Indies Cricket Board announced the sacking of West Indies T20 winning captain Darren Sammy. The news coincided with the island's hosting of the first international match played at the newly renamed Darren Sammy National Cricket Ground. That's when India played the West Indies as part of a four-match test series. It also came after he had led his team to a World T20 victory against England at Eden Gardens months before. The move did not go down well with cricket fans. It evoked outrage from local and regional politicians as well. The former West Indies Cricket Board CEO, Ernest Hille, joined St. Vincent and the Grenadines Prime Minister, Dr. Ralph Gonsalves, in condemning the shabby treatment meted out to Sammy. Sammy was informed of his sacking in a 30-second phone call that prompted the St. Vincent Prime Minister to write a strongly worded letter to the head of the selection committee. The politician called on cricket fans to boycott the remaining test matches. The regional media fraternity was shocked by the sudden death of communications officer of the Castries-based OECS Commission, Raymond O'Keefe. Antiguan-born O'Keefe passed away in Martinique, where he was being treated for an undisclosed illness. OECS Director General Dr. Didikus Jules broke the sad news. He described the host of the daily OECS Newslink radio program as deeply passionate about OECS integration and a major advocate for it.
Everyone at the Commission is stricken with grief and sadness at his passing. Raymond is one of those persons who was very enthusiastic about everything he did. He did it with great exuberance and encouragement, a good encourager of other persons to participate in everything having to do with the Commission. He was deeply passionate about OECS integration and was a major advocate for it. His the radio program he did, OECS Link, spoke to that passion. So he'll be greatly missed, and we are working closely with his family to help them get through this.
O'Keefe was described as a beloved and close member of the broader media family, who left an incredible mark through his work and interactions with media colleagues.
Raymond was a very jovial person. He had this knack of always being able to make you laugh. No matter how down you are or how impressed you were, Raymond had a way of cheering you up. You know, I had the pleasure of working with Raymond here at ABS Radio and also corresponding with him when he was at the OECS News Desk. I can remember just prior to him going on vacation, the day before going on vacation, he called to inform me that he was going on vacation, but someone else would be handling the OECS Newslink while he was out.
Several dignitaries and media professionals would turn out to the Anglican Church in Castries to pay their final respects to the 49-year-old journalist and father of two. Complaints about mold and general health and safety concerns led to the decision to relocate some divisions of the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College. Renovation work at the college resulted in the relocation of classes to the George Child Secondary School in Cul-de-Sac. Meanwhile, the operations at the George Child School were moved to the John Odlum Secondary School in Marigot. Within days of the commencement of the new school term, students of the Sir Arthur Lewis Community College would stage protest action over conditions at the George Child Secondary School. The Minister for Education met with staff of the three institutions affected by the relocation to ensure a smooth transition and that all concerns were addressed. A crime spree targeting city businesses spilled into July. For weeks, city businesses were being plundered and left with thousands of dollars in damages and lost merchandise. It seems no business was spared, from jewelry stores to major department stores. All were fair game for the bandits. In some cases, the businesses were repeatedly targeted by the thieves. Courts, St. Lucia, and its Chaussee Road branch hit several times, with bandits making off with thousands of dollars in electronic items. The impact of the crime on the economy was a concern for Prime Minister Alan Chastney, especially at the time when the island is so heavily dependent on tourism and was trying to attract more direct foreign investment.
We're actually looking to resolve the home for the justice system. The idea of courts all over the place is not working. We're looking to get the DPP put in place as quickly as possible. As you'll know, that Cabinet just approved the amendment to allow the DPP salary to be increased. So we want to get a DPP in as quickly as possible so we can get some activation on some of the critical cases. There's a huge backlog that we need to be able to resolve. In terms of the police, the building that the Prime Minister had earmarked for himself at the old Golden Hope site, we're agreed to convert that now into the new police headquarters. So I have them actually putting together a presentation for Cabinet so we could make that final decision. We're also looking to move the Marine Police Station over to that location. I've also asked my ministry to look at the conversion of customs into a border control, both for the Marine Police and as well as immigration.
The Minister for National Security also expressed concern about the spate of shootings and burglaries occurring in the city and held talks with the police with a view to coming up with a solution to the problem.
I am very concerned as to what's happening. We can see that there are quite a few young persons who are actually doing this sort of things. We have identified who some of the young people are, and the police are going to be working assiduously in dealing with that. Only yesterday I met with the mayor and his councillors and the commissioner of police and ACP Pelius, and they are going to be looking at implementing the city police, revamping it, and I think that will assist us in the city.
Security in the city was also high up on the agenda when the Taiwanese ambassador met with the new Castries mayor in August. Commerce Minister Bradley Felix gave assurance that government was exploring its options to deal with the situation by encouraging businesses to beef up their own security in response.
You're watching the DBS The End Review 2016. We'll be back. Thank you so much for staying with the broadcast. In September, St. Lucia's worst fears were realized. With the wounds inflicted by Hurricane Tomas and the Christmas Eve trough still fresh, disaster agencies warned that a potentially dangerous weather system was approaching the island.
Emergency services were put on high alert as the approaching system became more defined and better organized.
From my assessment, the system is fairly large. It will begin affecting us sometime late tonight into tomorrow. I expect tomorrow will be cloudy, and I expect it will be a rainy day tomorrow. And I also expect the worst. We'll get the worst tomorrow night into Thursday.
Well, we just had a NEMAC meeting in light of the impending weather system to ensure that all our own systems are in place, all agencies are prepared, are in a state of readiness, and should we be hit by the impending weather system after the strike, that we'll be in a position to respond immediately.
The Ministry of Health also activated its disaster response teams and plans. Meetings with various department heads at health institutions around the island were held as the ministry moved to ensure continuity of medical services during the passage of the storm.
We have organized to ensure that facilities at strategic prioritized points are kept open to ensure care for the public. We also want to advise the public that during the storm that they try to keep as safe as possible and not wander out where they could get injured and hurt during the process as well. We also want them to take all the necessary precautions, especially persons who have elderly families or small children, persons as well who are with chronic diseases, to ensure that they have a supply of their medication.
And then the storm, which by now had been named Matthew, arrived. It blew across the island, snapping tree branches, leaving entire communities underwater and triggering multiple landslides. After being pummeled for several hours by heavy rains and strong winds from Tropical Storm Matthew that Wednesday, a massive cleanup effort would begin. By midday the Thursday, things were beginning to get back to normal. Roads were being cleared, power lines were being restored, and trees were being chopped down. While some people had to be evacuated from their homes, there was no loss of life reported. Residents of Bexar and Cicero, like other areas affected by the storm, got to work cleaning up the mess left in the wake of Tropical Storm Matthew. The storm also made the Badaline impassable, but police and Ministry of Infrastructure officials went to work cutting down fallen trees and clearing landslides. Police detectives were also kept busy investigating a rash of break-ins during the passage of Tropical Storm Matthew. The storm had left most of the country in complete darkness, but power company crews were able to restore the supply to most of the island within hours of the storm's passage. Most of the health institutions fared well under the onslaught from Tropical Storm Matthew. St. Jude, Victoria, Denry, and Soufre hospitals, as well as the National Mental Wellness Center, were all able to deliver uninterrupted service during the passage of the storm. There were few persons accessing medical services and few storm-related injuries.
For most of our other healthcare facilities, we expect to get full use of services from tomorrow, Friday, September 30th. We expect all of our services to be back on par. For the St. Jude Hospital, National Mental Wellness Center, and also the Victoria Hospital, we have suspended the outpatient clinic services and also the elective surgeries. But by tomorrow, those services will be reinstituted and will be back full-fledged as per the normal operations. Of concern to the Ministry of Health is the fact that potable water, that is our Wasco water supply, is not back on for some communities and also for electricity. So in terms of the quality of the water quality and food safety is of concern to us. We are advising the public to ensure safe water use practices if the water is not coming from our potable supply of Wasco, to ensure that the water is either boiled or the use of water sterilization.
Some of the other community wellness centers, however, were forced to keep their doors closed due to the loss of electrical power and potable water. Mark Bexar residents who have borne the brunt of past weather events experienced more flooding as the storm rolled across the island, dumping several millimeters of rain on the flood-prone communities. The Denry South community had a similar story. The community was mostly affected by flooding, something residents have had to contend with for years, but were calling for a permanent solution too. The community of Magritoot Miku also took a severe pounding from Tropical Storm Matthew. Residents there have developed a unique way of dealing with such events. Having been battered by successive weather events, they chose to throw a street party to celebrate life rather than focusing on the destruction these events usually bring. Other residents fared better and narrowly escaped any serious damage to their property. The St. Lucia Cadet Group was activated to assist with the supply management component of relief efforts.
Prior to the storm, the cadets are placed on standby. Then, as soon as we get the all clear, we activate. And cadets are very responsive. They come in and we wait out. We're supposed to make deliveries to specific areas. Shelters are usually the primary response area.
Prime Minister Alan Chastney, who had been off island, returned and immediately met with his cabinet of ministers and emergency agency representatives for an update. The Prime Minister took an aerial tour to assess the damage and reported that the storm had decimated the island's agriculture sector. Farmers across the island were facing immeasurable crop losses that would certainly take a long time to recover from. As the storm left the island, it was upgraded to a Category 3 hurricane. Watches or warnings were posted in Jamaica, Haiti, Cuba, and the Bahamas. Back in St. Lucia, the National Emergency Management Organization began its official post-storm damage assessment. The Ministry of Infrastructure dispatched workers throughout the island to clear fallen trees and other debris that Matthew left behind. The experience led to new calls for the legislation of building codes to guide all infrastructural development on the island.
After months of pressure from the United States and European Union governments to do so, a new director of public prosecutions was appointed, along with the new attorney general. School security became a national concern after several schools around the island were burgled and students robbed. In at least one case, the security guards on duty were brutally beaten. Security at the island's lone penal institution underwent a review following the escape of an inmate.
Darson Green was sworn in as the island's new director of public prosecutions. In October, Green replaced Victoria Charles Clark and would hold the post for 1 year. The new DPP would be under tremendous pressure and security to bring the Lamberts and Impacts human rights cases to an end during that year. The government had been under pressure from the EU and US to resolve both matters. A new attorney general in the person of Stephen Julian was sworn in October. Julian had previously served as St. Lucia's Consul General to Canada and was former magistrate. Both appointments drew criticism from the SLP, with the leader of the opposition cautioning both the government and the new acting DPP against the appearance of political interference in the operations of that office. He also took issue with the change in Attorney General. While Philip Pierre said he has no issue with the appointment of Stephen Julian, his concern was about the treatment of the former Attorney General Kim St. Rose. The need for better school security was forced into the spotlight after a group of St. Mary's College students were accosted and robbed by bandits on at least two occasions. In one of these cases, the students were robbed while on school property. The Ministry of Education said concrete steps would be taken to improve school security after the daring attack and robbery. As it turns out, several schools around the island had been hit by thieves. The situation is serious enough to prompt Prime Minister Alan Chastney and Minister Home Affairs, the National Security Senator Herman Gill Francis, to publicly denounce the activity. Things took a violent turn when a group of men beat and tied up the security guard at the St. Mary's College before breaking into the school. Police interrupted the robbery and gave chase, but none of the thieves were apprehended. Classes were suspended at the school, and government again issued a warning to the perpetrators of the crime.
They took some cell phones and laptops that were in there, looking for small things apparently. And they went to the bursar's office, attempted to get in there, unsuccessfully, because that's a very heavily secured room, they couldn't get in. They went to the counselor's room, which doesn't have anything much to steal, and ransacked that one. The staff room was ransacked as well, looking apparently for small valuable items. There was, fortunately, a gentleman across the road, a security guy himself who works elsewhere, who happened to have been awake and he heard a noise. And he was experienced enough to recognize that noise to be a strange sound for midnight. So he came down, and when he came down, he saw one of the watchmen tied. And then he called the police. Fortunately or unfortunately, the police fired a volley of shots and didn't hit anybody. The guys all escaped. but they escaped with a hail of bullets chasing them. I don't know, the hail is a little high though, that's the only thing, that it seems to have gone over their heads. It's really a disturbing scene now and situation in the schools, because this is not the first school we've had, from what I gather, but 6 or 7 schools in the vicinity of this one broken into over the past 5 weeks or so.
Angry parents met with school authorities to identify solutions to the problem. Police would eventually take 3 men into custody and recover 1 laptop belonging to the school. They also announced arrest in connection with a similar burglary at the Castries Comprehensive Secondary School. In light of the incidents, Education Minister Dr. Gail Rigobert said steps would be taken to boost security at all the island's schools. In October, the Calypso and Carnival fraternity came together to stage a chanting for Get Through benefit concert on behalf of ailing Calypsonian Get Through. The concert was organized to not only raise funds to assist with the artist's medical expenses, but organizers hoped it would lay the foundation for the establishment of a permanent fund to assist all musicians. Similar concerts were held for the leader of the Socalypso Review Tent, Jean Leon, and music producer Francis Libo de Lima. Both had been diagnosed with cancer. Sadly, Get Through would pass away on the very day that the benefit concert was being held to assist him with his medical expenses. Part of the monies raised at the concert was presented to the family to assist with his burial expenses. It was announced that the balance of the funds would go toward the establishment of a distress fund for ailing musicians. A massive manhunt was launched after a prisoner escaped from the Bordelais Correctional Facility. 33-year-old Hanson James, alias Dirty White of Cicero, was serving time for stealing and gross indecency. He was serving a concurrent sentence of 4 and 7 years. James was found by police and correctional officers under a house in Montparnasse. Correctional officers credited the public and social media for the quick recapture of the escaped convict.
By afternoon, we got our real first break where the police actually had some sighting of him. But being the individual that he is, he eluded them for a little while. But by then, I was very confident that it was just a matter of time before we got Janssen. And at 9:30 p.m. last night, I got a call from the staff, from the commander, who informed me that Janssen has been recaptured.
Local advocacy group Raise Your Voice St. Lucia took several government departments to task for their silence following news that a teenage inmate at the Bordelais Correctional Facility had given birth to her second baby.
We're not sure why she was convicted, if she was convicted, but what we do know for sure is that she was a ward of the state. She was supposed to be at the transit home, and we are aware that the staff of the transit home had a problem with her being there. So the question that we are asking is, if with all the social workers, the counselors, the clinical psychologists, the government engages to rehabilitate children who are at risk, and the transit home is one of the safety nets that the government has put in place, then why is she at the Bordelais Correctional Facility? And we have to ask of the professional, what was their part in her being at the Bordelais Correctional Facility? We are very concerned about that. This child is underage. This is an adult facility. They're not supposed to be housing anybody under 18.
The mother of the teenager also laid blame for her daughter's incarceration at the feet of the dysfunctional social services department and a broken judicial system.
I tried, but at the time she wasn't in my custody. She was taken from me from the age of 10, from human services, transit home. So at the time of the first baby, she wasn't in my custody. She was in human services custody. So when I went to see my daughter, she was fidgeting, trembling. Like, she's shocked. And they tell you only when people finish give birth and the trembling is only when they're in shock. My daughter says she has no volunteers. They say that's the best place. So she has volunteers. She has all kind of people. That's not true. No, I went there today. I just coming from there. She said she has no volunteers. She said they had one girl that used to come and help her from the prison safe that used to come and help her. They removed the girl from by her. And now she's in her only thing with her daughter by herself. And she has to do everything for herself.
The Department of Human Services attempted to clear the air on the matter, but its explanation would fall on deaf ears. Raise Your Voice St. Lucia would continue to apply pressure on the Human Services Department to do a better job of protecting the vulnerable. The organization said the social services were failing in their duties towards young people in their care.
The DBS Year in Review will continue in just a moment. Welcome back to the broadcast. In November, the new government made good on its election campaign promise and announced a new VAT rate. His Royal Highness Prince Henry of Wales visited the island as part of a Caribbean tour and found himself at the center of a war of words between the government and the opposition. In stunning repudiation of the establishment, billionaire businessman Donald J. Trump was elected as President of the United States, raising concerns about what his presidency could mean for the island and the region. Also in November, a longtime friend of St. Lucia and the Caribbean, Fidel Castro, passed away.
Prime Minister Alan Chesney, during an address to the nation, announced a reduction in the island's VAT rate. The new rate would take effect on February 1, 2017. The new rate was part of a Five to Stay Alive proposal presented during the election campaign. That plan would see the reduction and eventual removal of the value-added tax. The new rate was 12.5%. Government also announced that it would consider a recommendation from the Caribbean Development Bank that St. Lucia reduce the number of VAT-exempt items. In November, Donald Trump was elected President of the United States in a stunning upset that defied polls leading up to the election. The news raised several concerns over what a Trump presidency could mean for regional economies. The island's agriculture minister seemed unperturbed, suggesting that Trump would not be able to act on some of the drastic campaign promises, including threats to deport 11 million illegal immigrants, including St. Lucians, from the U.S.
I can tell you personally, and that's my personal opinion, that all the things, all the rhetoric Donald Trump said on the political platform leading up to general elections would not be fulfilled. I think he saw it as a means of politicking, but I do not believe in his right sense that he would be able to accomplish most of what he has said. I am hoping that he will be guided, and lately you've seen that he's been guided, and he would implement some of the policies that he believes would be able to impact positively on America. And if that is achievable, we shall benefit.
A former St. Lucia ambassador to the United Nations called for a wait-and-see approach.
Most obvious thing is his immigration policy, where he has proposed sending 11 million people back and building a wall along the southern border. So we wait to see how those things are going to pan out. I think they're going to be more difficult to implement than to say. But from the point of view of the Caribbean, this is the aspect that one would have to watch. In terms of other relations, strangely enough, since Ronald Reagan, the Republican Party has in fact been better to the Caribbean than the Democrats.
Vice Chancellor of the University of the West Indies, Sir Hilary Beckles' reaction to the win was that no good would come to the Caribbean as a result of Trump's victory. In fact, Sir Hilary went a step further and called Trump's election a retrograde step that would take the U.S. back by several decades to the days of Plantation America, when blacks had little or no civil rights and white supremacy was the order of the day. The island's national security minister was also very concerned about the possible fallout and suggested that the entire region should be concerned.
This is an important juncture in our history.
And I think that the prime ministers of the Caribbean islands will meet and will have some dialogue with the new president. I don't want to jump to conclusions as to what will happen, but I think the ministers will be proactive in having some audience with them and telling them of their concerns.
Meanwhile, tourism officials reported a dip in bookings out of the U.S. following the Trump victory. This was in keeping with pre-election predictions.
So we are happy to discount the current lag in bookings to that effect. And now that we have passed and we have gone beyond that, we're optimistic that we will see an increase in these bookings over the winter season. Right now, the feedback reaching me is that there is still tremendous room for improvement in terms of our booking forecast.
While travel to the U.S. would be dictated by Trump's immigration policies, experts said outbound travel would depend on the health of the U.S. economy under his stewardship, since a weak dollar could deter Americans from leaving home. The director of the St. Lucia Tourist Board, Louis Lewis, and his deputy, Tracy Warner-Arnold, quit their posts in November. The resignation followed the announcement of plans to transition the SLTB to a tourism authority. In this regard, SLTB staff were informed that they would have to reapply for jobs under the new entity. The news prompted president of the Civil Service Association, Yvonne Edwin, to write to the St. Lucia Tourist Board on the matter. Meanwhile, an audit of the St. Lucia Tourist Board's finances got underway. Minister in the Ministry of Tourism, Dominic Faye-Day, promised that the findings would be made public. Economic Development Minister Guy Joseph, along with police and the customs officers, went in search of supplies reportedly belonging to the St. Jude Hospital, which were reportedly being stored at various locations on the island. He was barred from entering one of the locations on the grounds that monies owed for storing the items had not been paid.
We have been met with some resistance from the owners of the property, in that while it is goods paid for by the government and there's a clear contract that what they had to do was to supply and install, we are not ready for the installation, but we wanted to take all of the goods that belong to St. Jude so we can store it on site, because presently we are paying heavy insurance premiums for St. Jude, the St. Jude site, and all the goods that we have should be at least on site, or if it's duty free, should be in a place where, like the free zone in Viewfort. And that is why I'm a bit lost as to why we have about 5 or 7 locations of warehouses up in the north for St. Jude when we have the free zone. We have so many NDC buildings available down in the south.
Guy Joseph began demanding answers after accompanying Health Minister Mary Isaac and the Chief Executive Officer of the hospital on a tour of the St. Jude reconstruction site in June. Joseph wanted an explanation from contractors for the delay in the completion of the hospital.
There seemed to be no sense of clear direction as to what is happening. There's a lot of work being done around St. Jude's, the core of the hospital operations, but the hospital itself, the level of attention that should be paid to it has not been paid. And it is of great concern to me that it seemed to be that this project was just evolving on a daily basis. It did not look like a project that there was the level of planning, the level of structure.
The minister would later initiate a technical audit to determine whether the reconstruction of the St. Jude Hospital was being undertaken in a prudent and legitimate manner. The minister attracted criticism for his refusal to identify the auditors who were being paid several $100,000 of taxpayers' money. He was similarly criticized for his actions in interfering in what some saw as a law enforcement issue.
This certainly was not a place for a minister of government to be. You are not any law enforcer, and that should be the job or the work of law enforcement. I believe very strongly that he had no business being there. And I would strongly support whatever actions that are taken against him to make him understand that he has a place in government and not in law enforcement.
In November, St. Lucia rolled out the red carpet for His Royal Highness Prince Henry of Wales. His Royal Highness would spend 14 days in the region, representing the Queen at various functions, including participating in celebrations of the 35th anniversary of independence in Antigua and Barbuda and the 50th anniversary of independence in Barbados and Guyana. Prince Harry arrived at Point Serafin, where he received an official welcome. The following morning, he participated in an exhibition cricket match at the Darren Sammy Cricket Ground. The event saw His Royal Highness playing against a team headed by the Prime Minister. St. Lucia's Prime Minister got a royal thrashing at the hands of Prince Harry and it dominated the English press. The visiting prince scored 9 runs off 3 balls bowled by the Prime Minister. Following the match, the Prince and the Prime Minister presented medals to their respective teams and exchanged signed cricket bats. His Royal Highness would journey to Pigeon Island to attend an outdoor exhibition highlighting various conservation projects run by the young people of St. Lucia. Prince Harry also unveiled the dedication plaque designating the Castries Waterworks Reserve and surrounding rainforest as St. Lucia's contribution to the Queen's Commonwealth Canopy Project. The Prince then travelled by boat to Souffre, arriving at the harbour to the sights and sounds of a St. Lucian street festival with traditional food and drink on offer at local market stalls. Prince Harry took the opportunity to meet members of the public, youth leaders and local school children, with a St. Lucian band providing the soundtrack. His Royal Highness was also a guest of honor at the sword turning ceremony for the US $2.6 billion Desert Star holding project in Vieux-Fort. His participation in the event would be the subject of a heated exchange between the government and opposition SLP. The SLP took issue with the Prince Henry of Wales' participation in the sword-turning ceremony, accusing the government of manipulating the prince to participate in this ceremony. The government expressed disappointment with the opposition statement.
But basically, we're saying that the St. Lucia Labour Party should not just oppose things for opposing sake. If you, as we came in as a new administration, we recognize that this was a project that would have been beneficial to St. Lucia. We did not play politics with it. We decided to continue with the project. We decided to finalize maybe just the nitty-gritty and the little loose ends of the framework agreement and to go ahead with the investor to enter into that project.
Cuban President Fidel Castro passed away in November. His death has triggered both celebration and mourning as critics welcomed his passing while supporters grieved for the polarizing strongman who dominated Cuba for decades. His brother Raul Castro announced his death in a televised statement. Prime Minister Alan Chastney responded to the news and sent condolences to the government and people of Cuba on behalf of the government and people of St. Lucia. He referred to the former revolutionary leader as truly remarkable and an incredible figure in world history.
I think that the president is an incredible figure in our life history in terms of what he's achieved and what he did for his own country and what he has done for the Caribbean in terms of education and particularly healthcare, being a real revolutionist, and whether one agrees with everything, the ideology of Mr. Castro, you certainly have to appreciate his tenacity and what he did for his own people. And you know, certainly by extension, what he did for St. Lucia, what he did for the rest of the Caribbean is really invaluable. And I think that I've already spoken to the ambassador of Cuba here this morning. I certainly want to extend our heartfelt sympathy to the nation of Cuba, to let them know that St. Lucia stands by their side in this time of mourning. My understanding is the country has called for 9 days of mourning. I'm going to ask that our flags be flown at half-mast in recognition of his passing.
Prime Minister Alan Chastney, the Minister for Health and Wellness Mary Isaac, and Member of Parliament for Labrie Alva Baptiste would go to Cuba to pay homage to the former Cuban president. The Cuban embassy in St. Lucia made a book of condolences available for signature. The death of Cuban President Fidel Castro has cast a dark cloud over the Cuban embassy here in St. Lucia. The embassy is now open to the public for the signing of the Book of Condolence. The Cuban ambassador describes the situation as the end of an era in Cuban history and the world by extension.
This is a very most important moment in the history of our country. We are deeply in pain and very saddened by the news of the passing, the physical passing of our commander-in-chief, the commander-in-chief of the Cuban Revolution. We doubt that in our lifetimes we will witness any funeral or any moment of this magnitude in Cuba. At the same time, we feel very strong about the legacy of Fidel, the meaning of Fidel, the significance of Fidel for our country and our people. Cuba is Fidel and Fidel is Cuba. And we are totally confident and sure and mostly determined to continue his legacy.
Journalist Earl Busque joined others in highlighting Cuba's invaluable contribution to regional development.
After independence, and St. Lucia established diplomatic relations with Cuba, Fidel Castro ensured that the scholarships that were offered to St. Lucia and subsequently to other countries were aimed primarily at ensuring that the sons and daughters of poor St. Lucians who could not afford university education for their bright children to get those opportunities. And you would notice that the first set of St. Lucians who studied in Cuba were along those lines.
As the year began, so it ended, with crime and security at the forefront of everyone's minds. Crimes against businesses continued. More lives were lost to suspected gang violence. And the murder of a 76-year-old in a home put an entire nation on edge. Women in particular took to social media to express their fears and to repeat calls made earlier in the year for pepper spray, tasers, and other personal protection devices to be more readily available.
The first week of December, like the first week of January, was marred by more violence. 23-year-old Denzel Starver of Darling Road was shot but was able to walk out of the Victoria Hospital after being treated for his injuries. 27-year-old Citygate resident Shane Emmanuel, alias T-Mob, was not so lucky. His body was found by police near the road with several apparent gunshots about his body.
The police lady hold me in my hand and she tell me, do come up. I tell her, why do come up? Because. So she telling me, is Shane that on the floor? I say, Shane that on the floor. What happened? She telling me they shot Shane.
Nearly 3 years after two medical students were run over by a car, killing one of the students, the man behind the wheel appeared in court. The parents of Omotayo Morrison, the third trimester student who died, also made an appearance in the hope that the case would finally come to an end.
It is very, very financially, you know, it's very draining on us because we are not wealthy people. You know, we are not business men and women. We are professionals just struggling to make a living. We have two daughters in the university and we have to pay for their tuition fees. So, and as you know, tuition fees in the Canada is very expensive, yes. So we are, you know, we are holding on.
The judge would eventually rule that Caleb Antoine of Cedar Heights Viewfort would have to pay $10,000 within 6 months or face a year behind bars for causing death by dangerous driving. With public concern about the spate of robberies and shootings mounting, the police instituted a number of measures to combat crime during the holiday season. Traditionally, the lawmen have noted a spike in crime during that time of year. But the lawmen were forced to go on the offensive and defend themselves against reports that they planned on conducting random searches of citizens.
If there is reasonable suspicion, and I say if the police have reasonable suspicion, to stop somebody, speak with them, and if this goes on to searching the person for the possibility of finding an illegal weapon, a knife, a firearm, we will do so, but we must first establish that there is reasonable grounds for doing so.
Castries Mayor Peterson Francis, meanwhile, outlined his plans to take the city back from criminals. For months, city residents and business owners had been expressing frustration after bandits went on a crime spree with several robberies and shootings in the capital. Among his plans was the swearing in of additional city constables to patrol the streets.
So soon, you'll be seeing at least 30 for the first instance. We are already in the process of interviewing, because the first complement of city police that I want is 50. And we are looking at a 24 hours. We are bringing back the old police concept, beat and patrol.
Days before Christmas, the island was shocked by the news of the murder of a 76-year-old resident of Marisil, Rose Ann Raymond, the 28th homicide for 2016. Police received the report of the homicide about 10:30 p.m. on Saturday, 10th December. The body of the deceased was discovered at her residence. She was later conveyed to the Victoria Hospital, where she was pronounced dead by a medical practitioner.
I would now like to appeal to members of the public in obtaining any information that we can in relation to any individual or individuals they may have seen inside or around a red Hyundai hatchback motor car which belonged to the deceased. The registration number is PA484. And this vehicle was on the John Compton Highway next to the NIS building, NIC building that is, between the hours of 8 p.m. Friday, December 9th, 2016, and 2 a.m. Sunday, December 11th, 2016.
Raymond's car had been found near the government buildings in Castries. The Prime Minister and Minister for National Security both expressed grief over Raymond's murder. Prime Minister Alan Chastney, like his predecessor, expressed outrage, revulsion and anger over violent crimes against women generally.
And while, as a Prime Minister of your country, we take full responsibility and that we will do everything that we can to apprehend the person who committed or persons who committed this crime, we could never change St. Lucia by ourselves. This is going to require all of St. Lucia to be outraged. All of St. Lucia and St. Lucians to take a stance on this situation.
Meanwhile, the St. Lucia Crisis Center began applying pressure on the police to ensure that the perpetrators of the murder were caught and brought to justice.
This is something we've been condemning all along, the abuse of the elderly and rape and all of this thing. And right now this thing has taken to a new level, which is, you know, rape and actually killing the person, you know. Our sympathies and condolences go out to the family of this latest victim. We categorically condemn this kind of behavior.
57-year-old Hippolyte Glasgow of Mondor Anstere would become the next victim of gun violence after finding himself in the wrong place at the wrong time. According to reports, two unmasked males were fleeing from Elcock's supermarket after an alleged robbery when several gunshots were fired, resulting in Glasgow being hit in the chest.
I live in Monsies with my girlfriend, so this morning I get up to go and do my little work. So my girlfriend get a phone call telling me so that they shot my father. They had a robbery at Pope in Mondo. So I rushed down here to see what's going on. I think probably he know the fellas. That is what I could say. I feel very bad about it. So sad, because my father never do nothing to nobody. He's not a troublemaker. He's only do his little work, come back home, chill out. Don't look for trouble with nobody. And that is it. So I don't know why somebody choose to do him that.
Sadly, not even tourists were spared by the criminals. With the tourist season at its peak and the streets teeming with visitors, the criminals saw an opportunity and seized it. Quick-thinking vendors at the Castries market were able to foil at least one attempted robbery of a cruise ship visitor. The tourist was tackled by a bandit while attempting to make a purchase from a vendor. The robbery of two other visitors further angered craft vendors, who said such attacks were bad for business. They called for tough measures to dissuade would-be criminals.
When they have tourists in the harbor, and like Sunday holiday, they should have police around everywhere, because the young fella, they don't have nothing to do just to watch the tourists and take what they have. Just now, we'll not have no tourists in St. Lucia, because when they start like that, the people go back and they tell the government that they will not come to St. Lucia anymore, and we go suffer all of us go suffer. It's time for police to be around to take them little boys, give them a good licking and put them inside. That's what I say. I don't see nothing else to do them. Give them a good licking. Beat them. Good, beat them. Bring them on the square and beat them on the square.
But vendors weren't the only ones concerned. Crime against tourists was a great concern to cruise merchants. The mugging of visitors in the city prompted tour companies to meet with the mayor's office and police to discuss a response to the problem. 4 years before, Norwegian Cruise Lines pulled the island off its itinerary over concerns for passenger safety. Tour companies were desperate to avoid a repetition of that incident.
My understanding is that there will be additional persons deployed. We have been advised of this. And this was prior to this. It's not happening just because of the muggins that have been just happened. It was in discussion, and we have seen a few more police out on the ground, and there are going to be even more. It's just that everything couldn't be done straight away.
The crimes against visitors persisted. The Castries mayor responded to pressure from the business community and cruise merchants by swearing in 25 additional city constables. Within hours, two thieves who had attempted to rob another tourist found themselves out of luck when nearby plainclothes police officers caught them in the act.
I've got the chain down, that's all that really matters. Okay,
were they brandishing any weapons?
No mask, nothing at all. But difficult to describe it to anyone in the city. In fact, I think that's the chap there.
Police Commissioner Severin Marchery used the arrest of the two thieves to send a clear message to would-be criminals.
We'll continue to ensure that we have boots on the streets. So we'll pull out officers from our 824 departments to put on the streets. Some of the non-conventional police departments, we will have them on the street. We will have some extra police officers from some of the courts that will be closed for the season. So we can assure our people that we will be out there. They will see police officers out there. And even sometimes when they do not see uniform officers, we may very well have plainclothes officers around.
Former UWP chairman Michael Flood had a close encounter with two gun-wielding men days before Christmas. Flood found himself in an armed standoff with the two men after repeated attempts by them to block his vehicle and a chase that ended at Rodney Bay with guns drawn.
When he realized I was serious, his hand dropped to his side with the firearm in his hand. But I kept my firearm drawn at him. Then people started coming. All right, people started congregating, a taxi driver, a cousin of mine, then there was the security from the JQ Mall and other people. It was then when I looked, I saw a car coming towards me, and I recognized the car. The owner of that car is a police officer who is married to my wife's cousin. So I recognized, so I wave her stop and I call her, come. So apparently when they realized she was coming towards me, walking towards me, they probably realized she's a police officer. They took the car and they fled off in the Groseley area.
A shooting at Conway claimed the life of Junior Scotland, a resident of that community, and took the number of homicides for the year to 30. National Security Minister Hermenegild Francis said the shootings raised important questions about how the criminals were obtaining the illegal guns and what the police and courts could do to make obtaining them more difficult. More violence would interrupt the Christmas vacation. On Christmas Eve, the sound of gunfire was heard in the Grass Street area shortly after 8 p.m. Police would later identify the victim as Curtis Mark, alias Smiley. His death would bring the number of homicides for 2016 to 31. In December, the business community mourned the death of Christopher Rennick, OBE, who passed away on Saturday, 17th December. Mr. Rennick was the founder and managing director of Rennick & Company Limited. His daughter, Cheryl Rennick, said the response to his death was overwhelming, with calls of condolence coming from all across the globe.
I guess there are not too many men like Mr. Rennick left in our business community. He's one of the older persons. He's the founder of Rennick & Company. We just celebrated 50 years this year. His legacy is about people. He is a people person, and that is why he is a special person to so many people regardless. And he'll be sorely missed, not just by us as a team but and a family, but, you know, people in St. Lucia.
News of his passing was met with surprise from many in the business community who would acknowledge his outstanding contributions to the local business sector and the national economy.
when Chris left Willie's firm to go off on his own, he took what was then a franchise, Tigadis Grant, from Trinidad, and he started off with that. He then converted that franchise into a St. Lucian company, Renican company, and ran it like that for 50 years. So it's almost a reverse of what we see happening now, but it's credit to a man who, you know, certainly had the vision and the hard work to make that work and to make it work for him, his family, and his employees.
News of Renick's death was followed days later by the announcement of the passing of Sir Kenneth Dwight Vincent Venner, the former governor of the Eastern Caribbean Central Bank, or ECCB. Sir Dwight, who was the head of the ECCB from 1989 to 2015, died in St. Lucia on the evening of 22nd December.
He became one of the longest, if not the longest, serving governor of a central bank in the world. Created a model, I think, that's being envied, and it has tested the times. We've gone through recessions, we've gone through crisis after crisis, and yet our central bank stands strong. In fact, our currency is 100% backed. And I think that that foundation that was established for the bank was, everything was due to him in terms of what he did. His understanding of developing the private sector.
Tributes would pour in from many who had worked with Sir Dwight.
He was always magnanimous in allowing people to grow, allowing young persons to be nurtured, to be trained, and he was like a mentor to me. There was a period in my life when he was also the father figure in my life. He had a very engaging personality that was always one that was willing to listen, to counsel, and to allow someone to grow. He was never someone who was stingy with using resources of the institutions where he worked to lend to the personal development of the staff and the persons who worked around him. He was an extremely compassionate person. Like everything else, all of us are subject to the frailties of human nature, and no one is perfect. But the one thing that Dwight Venner stood out is he was a true Caribbean man.
He was also the person who had me to leave the Treasury to go to the Ministry of Health. You know, so he, I know him very well. Of late, when he moved to ECCB, you all know what has happened. We are able to cushion the financial crisis. Remember, that is under his watch, that the ECCB, our dollar has remained strong. Up to this day, when some people say that the ECC dollar will be devalued, honestly, Dwight, no, it remained strong.
Stay with us because the Yen Review 2016 will continue in just a moment. And so we've come full circle. From start to finish, many of this year's biggest news stories were centered on violence or general sense of fear. But there were also those things that drew us closer together and brought out the best in us. As we ring in 2017, we do so full of hope that the new year would bring a better world, that people will be kinder to each other, politicians less corrupt and more trustworthy, that there'll be less violence and poverty, and that each of us will play our part, no matter how small, to bring about the change we want to see. And so, as we bring the curtains down on this year in review, we remind you of the words of Brad Paisley, that tomorrow is the first blank page of a 365-page book. Write a good one. We'll see you back here next year to review some of the biggest stories of 2017. Until then, I'm Timothy Polio. On behalf of the entire news and production team, Happy New Year. The 2016 Year in Review was brought to you by Casabella and Rhythm FM.